Hi friends, good evening. I hope the audibility issues are fixed. Tejas sir and Ritvik sir did a lot of work for you guys. Am I audible and I won't be able to hear you? Whatever you have to tell, you have to text me. Good evening, Rahul. Hi, Kusma. We'll wait for 2 minutes and then start off. So let's start. First thing I'll tell you, that see, mains answer rating is the most important thing because prelims will not help you fetch a rank. Prelims will only give you an opportunity to write them. It's the mains answer rating which will ultimately fetch you marks and get you a rank at the civil services examination. So that is the importance of mains examination. Extremely, extremely important. One mistake which candidates do is most of them focus on prelims, solving prelims papers. They give less importance for mains. In fact, your mains should be ready even before you go for prelims. Because within 3 months, you won't be able to prepare for the entire main examination. So what you guys are doing is the best thing, that is preparing for mains now. Now, what is my telling you how to write mains answers? The reason is I've written 4 mains till now and I've cleared all the 4 mains. I've gone to the interview and I've cleared the examination twice. That is why I'm telling you how to write an answers. Now, few things like swimming, driving, just by telling you how to swim, you won't be able to swim. You have to actually write. You have to actually swim, go to the swimming pool, get into the pool. That is how you learn swimming. Similarly, answer writing. You have to write answers and you have to you slowly improve. It's not like directly from day one you write an answer and you write a very good answer. Slowly you will be bad, then you will become better, then you will become even better than that. So there is no alternative to answer writing. You have to start writing answers from day one. Don't worry about quality. Even if it's not too good, it's okay. Start writing answers. Now Tejas sir will give you 30 tests. Those 30 tests, I will discuss. Most of them, if time permits, I will only do it. It will have utility for you if you first write the test and then listen to the discussion, whether it is given by me or Tejas or anyone. First, you have to write the test. Because without the test, if without writing the test, whatever we tell, it won't help you much. So first thing is you have to write the test. Has anyone here written the test? No one? Fine. Okay, Praveen has written. Sunil has written. Very good, Praveen, Sunil. Okay. So, okay, most of you guys have written. That's very good. Very good, very good. Almost all of you have written. I'm very happy. Fine, go please. So how to write an answer? First thing, you have to stick to the word limit. That won't be much of a problem because UPSC will not give you unlimited number of answer sheets. They'll give you only a space in which you can write the answers. So one thing is you have to stick to the word limit. Second one is you have to write what they have asked, not what you know. So you have to look at the question. A question might have one part, two part, three parts. So whatever is the number of parts, you have to address all the parts. Next thing is for any question, there will be an introduction, a body and a conclusion. Introduction, you have to give a premise to the answer. Introduction can be a current affairs thing, or it can be findings of some committee report, or it can be something about its historical background. It can be anything. Then you come to the body where you write what they've actually asked. And then there is a conclusion where you conclude your answer based on whatever you have written in the introduction and the body. Everyone will write an answer. What makes your answer a very good answer? So what sets you apart? What makes you tell that you are the man among the boys or the woman or the lady among the girls? That is, there should be a punch in your answer. You need a punchy introduction, you need a punchy conclusion. They are very important. And in the body, whatever they have asked, you need to address that. So if you write like this, that is when you get good marks. And even half mark, one mark, that is all you have to fight for. Most of them will write an answer which is almost there. More than 90% will write. But very few percent, 5-10% will write an answer which is there. It is this difference which distinguishes the victor from the vanquished. If you write an answer which is almost there, you will not make it. You have to write an answer which is there. Then you can make your answers attractive by drawing maps, diagrams, flowcharts, but you should not force them into your answer. If situation permits, if there is a requirement, but you should not force it. But there has to be some X factor. It is just like most of you would be in the age of marriage. So there has to be, whenever you go to meet the groom or the bride, you have to show that you are better than others. Just like that, in UPSC, you can't show your face. You have to communicate to them through your answers that you are better than others. Okay? So, with this, do you have any general doubts about answer writing? Or I think we will take your questions at the end of the discussion. I will try to finish the discussion. We'll handle the individual questions. After every question, I'll give a pause. That time you can text me your questions with respect to that question. And finally, towards the end, whatever doubts you have in general, we will look into them. So, can we start? Okay, we'll start. I'll share my screen. Thank you. my purpose of telling you how to write answers is not to just read the synopsis. In fact, the synopsis, I have gone through the synopsis which has been given to you guys. It is of very high quality. In fact, really excellent answers have been written. Reading the synopsis will not help you a lot. So what I will do is I will give you a broad framework. I will give you some brief idea about all the questions and the answers. I think that will be more helpful than just reading out the synopsis. So reading the entire synopsis is your homework. Now I will tell you how to write the answers. See, look at the first question. Illustrate how pressure groups have emerged as a strong mechanism for making democracy participatory and responsive. So what are the requirements here? First, you need to know what is a pressure group. They have to give examples of various pressure groups. Then tell how it will help in making democracy participatory and responsive. What do you mean by pressure groups? Pressure groups are, I'll give you the first few examples, which most of you would have heard of. All of you would have heard about trade unions, INTUC, AITUC, Red Trade Union Congress. Then we have these business pressure groups like FICCI, ASSOCHAM, CII. Then we had in 2013 India Against Corruption Movement. That was a pressure group. Now, what is the general definition of pressure groups? Pressure groups are interest groups which try to serve the purpose of the members of that group. Example, I gave you an example of trade union. It's a pressure group. What is the interest? They have an interest. It consists of members who are homogeneous. That is, all the workers will be part of the trade union. Next one, what is the aim? Aim is to promote the interest of members of trade union, that is the workers. That is the idea of a pressure group. Now, what is the difference between pressure group and a political party? That can be another question. See, in a pressure group, it has a narrow membership. But in a political party, it includes all types of members. There is broad membership. A pressure group will handle only a few issues. For example, business pressure group will handle the issues of capitalists. Trade union pressure group will handle the issues of the workers of trade union. Then India Against Corruption, that pressure group. India Against Corruption, that pressure group, they will focus on just Lokpal. So they have a narrow working area. They handle all types of issues. For example, if you look at BJP party, they handle every type of issue with respect to trade, capitalism, foreign policy, domestic policy, with respect to every state. Then pressure groups don't try to capture power. Political parties try to capture political power. Pressure groups participate in elections. Political parties participate in elections. Okay, that is the difference between a pressure group and a political party. But the question is not about what is the difference. Question is how pressure groups makes Indian democracy participatory and responsive. See, this is what I have written so that it will help you. First, the introduction is I would define pressure groups, which I have already defined. Core features. I have told you the core features, the narrow membership, they do not participate in elections. Then is we have to give examples of pressure groups. I give you a few examples like business pressure groups, trade pressure groups, etc. Next, how do they make party government democracy participatory and responsive? See, in a democracy, for example, me and you vote once in 5 years. But after, in between elections, do we do much? We don't do much activity. But democracy is based on constant accountability, constant links with people. It is these pressure groups which fill this void in a democracy. That is, in between elections, these pressure groups continuously interact with the government, thereby ensuring that democracy continues in between the elections also. So how do they make democracy responsive and participatory? I've given various examples. One is it gives voice to the stakeholders. Example, trade unions, individually a worker in an industry does not have a strong voice. He's a weak person. But these trade unions give that worker a voice. So they give voice to the stakeholders. And also they give voice to the minority and the voiceless people. Example, we had the Mazdoor Kisan Sakti Sangatan. This is a pressure group. It was this pressure group which brought India one of its biggest transparency laws, RTI Act 2005. In fact, India's RTI Act is one of the best in the world. So they give voice to the voiceless and minorities. Next one, they promote transparency and accountability. For example, India Against Corruption movement, they did a lot of protest in Delhi, in Bangalore, so many other places. It led to transparency and accountability. We have the Lokpal Act, Lokayukta Act. Next, they nudge the government for pro-public policies. They have a pressure group called BMS, Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh. India, there was an organization called RCEP, consisting of ASEAN plus six countries. India wanted to join it. But this pressure group said that India should not join RCEP. It would hurt India's interests. So it nudged the government for pro-public policy. Next one, it puts pressure on the government to hear concerns of people. Example, anti-liquor campaign. Anti-liquor campaign happened in many states, most recently in Bihar, where women pressure groups put pressure on the government to hear their concerns. That is, they wanted prohibition of alcohol. Next one, they bridge the gap between public and the government. Example, there is a pressure group called Janagraha. It is from Bangalore. It is made up of members like Kiran Majumdar Shah of Biocon, TV Mohandas Pai, former Infosys CFO, all these people. They bridge the gap between the public and the government. Next one, they bridge the gap between industry and the government. Example, FICCI, ASSOCHAM, CII. And also, because of multiple pressure groups, if there is a balance in democracy, if there is only one pressure group, for example, assume that there was only FICCI, then what would happen? There would only be pro-capitalist policies in India. But because of FICCI as well as trade union pressure groups, there is a balance. Okay. Finally, they ensure that the majority community does not suppress the interests of minority community. It also ensures that only one segment, only one section of people does not get all the government benefits. So finally, conclusion is that pressure groups are very important for making democracy participative and responsive. The greater is the presence of diverse pressure groups. Okay. If you look at the synopsis, you will find few more good points that you can incorporate. And there is no just one way of writing the answer. This is just one way of writing the answer. There are so many other ways you can write an answer. But this is at least what you have to write in the answer. Anything more than this is always welcome. So we are done with one question. Now, anyone of you has a doubt with respect to this question? Anyone? Okay. Another 10 seconds, then I'll move on.
Hello.
Fine. Next one. Highlight the importance of State Finance Commission in strengthening fiscal federalism in India. Do you agree with the view that they have not been provided with necessary environment to play their rightful role? So what are the, let us identify the keywords. Keywords are State Finance Commission. So you have to talk about State Finance Commission. Next, you have to link it with fiscal federalism. Next, do you agree with the view that they have not been provided with necessary environment? Either you have to say yes or no. When you say yes, you have to give the explanation. When you have to say no, you have to give an explanation. So there are broadly three parts to the question. That is what we see here. See, first you have to talk about State Finance Commission. Next, you have to tell how State Finance Commission strengthens fiscal federalism. Next, you have to tell that these guys are not empowered. And finally, you have to give it. If they ask about a problem, you just not, should not stop at the problem. You also have to talk about the solutions. So you have to give few of your recommendations. And finally, conclude the answer. So that is the broad structure. Now, State Finance Commission, we had the 73rd, 74th Constitutional Amendment Act. They provided for State Finance Commission. What is the role of State Finance Commission? State Finance Commission first will do vertical devolution, that is distribution of net proceeds of taxes from the consolidated fund of the state between the state and the local bodies. That is called vertical devolution. That is, we have the state here and we have local bodies. So division between these things is called as vertical devolution. Now in vertical devolution, again, after vertical devolution, there is horizontal devolution. That is, how much funds will have to go for every local body. That is called horizontal devolution. So that is, one is vertical devolution, second is horizontal devolution, second, and third thing is the measures which are required for strengthening the finances of the Panchayat Raj institutions and the urban local bodies. So they will make recommendations with respect to that. Fourth, making recommendations about the taxes, duties, tolls, levies, which can be given to the local bodies for collection appropriation. Finally, any other matter referred by the governor in the interest of sound finance of the state. Who will appoint the State Finance Commission? It is the governor who will appoint. How frequently is it appointed? It is appointed once in 5 years. These things are mentioned in which article? Article 243I of the Constitution. So now we gave a brief background of State Finance Commission and its role. But question is not just that. Question is how it will strengthen fiscal federalism. How will it strengthen? It will ensure that there is fair distribution of finances between the state government and the local bodies. That is nothing but Panchayat Raj institutions and urban local bodies. That is the first thing. Second one, through grants in aid, they will ensure that there is financial independence for these local bodies. Third, we spoke about horizontal devolution, vertical devolution. Fourth, it will make independent local bodies, because without financial independence, they will not have independence in other spheres. Finally, it will lead to better capacity of the local body to deliver services to people. Sixth one, it will realize the vision of Article 44 of the Constitution. What is Article 44? It is a Gandhian article which says that the state shall promote the village panchayats. So it will strengthen Article 44. Because of this fiscal federalism, it will strengthen the ability of the local bodies to plan programs, schemes for development of the local areas. So that is how it will strengthen fiscal federalism. But next question is, the idea of State Finance Commission is very good. The envisaged role is very good, but is it fulfilling its role? No, the reason is no. What is the reason? Why it's not able to fulfill its mandate? Because a necessary, favorable environment has not been created. Why do I say that? The reason is, State Finance Commission is not appointed frequently. In many states, there is more than 10-year gap between appointment of State Finance Commission. Second, the State Finance Commission members are appointed by the governor on the advice of the executive. They are political appointees. They do not have any expertise. They show less interest in coming up with recommendations. Third one, even if they give recommendations to the governor, their report is not submitted before the state legislature. Hence, it is not implemented at all. Fourth one, the government is not duty-bound to accept the recommendations of State Finance Commission. It is the discretion of the state government to accept or reject them. Next, it is one of the optional provision under 74th Amendment. It means that it is left to the states to decide whether to, what is the role of State Finance Commission, what is the composition, what is working, everything is decided by the state government, the state legislatures. Because of that, there is huge state-to-state variation. There have been few states like Tamil Nadu where it has not worked well. There have been few states like Kerala where it has been working well. So there is huge state-to-state variation. Fifth one is, there is no synchronization of the working of Union Finance Commission and State Finance Commission. Union Finance Commission is relatively working very well, but there is no synchronization between State Finance Commission and Union Finance Commission. So these points are out of his folk. There is no timely appointment. Appointment is on political grounds. Recommendations not accepted in totality. Only a few recommendations are accepted. They are toothless tigers. What is the outcome? The outcome is that the local bodies are not at all empowered. Example, panchayats, more than 95% of the resource of panchayats is through fund transfers from the state and from the center. In respect of the urban local bodies, less than 40% is their own resources. In fact, financially, the panchayats are more disempowered than the urban local bodies. So that has been the condition now. Now, what is the recommendation? Recommendation is that first we need to amend Constitution, Article 243I, to strengthen the Finance Commission. We have to make it mandatory. The Constitution will have to provide for structure, composition, working. There has to be synchronization between the working of State Finance Commission and Union Finance Commission. Accepting the recommendations of the State Finance Commission should be made mandatory until and unless the state government gives precise reasons for not accepting them. And it should be mandatory for the governor to present the report of the State Finance Commission for the state legislature. So these are few of the recommendations. One more thing we can do is, we can make this, the center can make the states compete with respect to the performance of State Finance Commission. Center can say that, based on the, if State Finance Commissions are working well, we will give you more funds. If they're not working well, we will give you less funds. So that is competitive federalism. By making the states to compete with each other in this area of State Finance Commission, multiple objectives will be achieved. One is, there will be strengthened urban local bodies and panchayat raj institutions. Second one is, it will lead to a race to the top. So this is how you can conclude your answer. Any doubts about this? Can we move on? I'll give you 15-20 seconds. Sir, can you give an example as to what type of recommendations State Finance Commissions can give to the government? Okay, they can say that give, let the property tax be collected by BBMP, not by the state government. Second recommendation, out of whatever tax the state government collects, give 20% to the panchayats. Third recommendation, every year 1,000 crores will have to be given by the state to the urban local bodies and panchayats. So such kind of recommendations. Okay, Rahul. Anyone else? Fine, I'll move on. Next question. In India, modified the waste model of, in this context, discuss analytics and differences between political system of India and UK. First, you have to model. First part, we'll talk about, you'll tell what is the commonality and differences between political system of India and UK. What is Westminster model of government? India and ruled by Britain. Exposed model of the British model of Britain. Working in Britain for 200, then it was in all these Singapore. New Zealand export to British stuff. So becoming independent because they were already and this they were already at the end of that. How that it was working, copied that model countries. Copied few of the thing from British means it is a part of British. Because there is a place called Westminster where the governments by the Disway model. Now adopted the model that is the parliamentary form of government where the executive is responsible. Nominative, real executive is the president in the case of India, it is the queen in the case of England. That is the Westminster model. Now let us come to the second part. What is the commonalities? What is similarity between India and UK political systems? First thing is dual executive, nominal executive, real executive. Second is bicameralism. There are two houses. India, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha. Similarly in UK, there is House of Commons, House of Lords respectively. Third, cabinet system of governance. Fourth, leadership of prime minister. Cabinet headed by the prime minister. Fifth one, collective responsibility. That is the council of ministers swim together, sing together. Tomorrow, if our prime minister resigns, then the entire council of ministers will dissolve. The same is in, that we copied from Britain. Next, systems like question hour, where the MPs ask the questions to the ministers is borrowed. That is another similarity. Parliamentary privileges is one more similarity. Now, what are the differences? So, I haven't written much. See, parliamentary form of government, Westminster model, we have to discuss about that. After that, commonalities. Ideally, you can write any number of points. More the points, more is the mark. For just showing you, I have written that we have to write 5 points. So we are done with the commonalities. Next, we come to the differences. What are the differences? Indian model is republic. That is, anyone can, tomorrow, you and me can also become the nominal head. We can become the president of India. But in UK model, it's not a republic. There is monarchy. That is, the king or the queen alone can be the nominal executive, and it is the transfer of power is hereditary. The second difference is there is no shadow cabinet in India, but in UK there is shadow cabinet. What is shadow cabinet? Shadow cabinet means that even when the government is in power, there will be opposition cabinet where where MPs will be given portfolios. What is the reason of shadow cabinet? So that people know that if this government goes, who will come to power, which person which hold which ministry. That is one thing, there is clarity. Second one, people can make an objective choice as to which of the persons would do more justice to the ministry. Third one, it lead to specialization because, for example, if I am an opposition MP being told that you are in charge of home, then I would specialize in home. When I'm in opposition, I will continuously be looking into home ministry. And because of that, when I come into power, I can be a better minister. So it lead to specialization, better governance. So that is shadow cabinet system. Next one, in India, there is checks and balances. But in UK, there is less checks and balances because there is parliamentary sovereignty. Whatever bill is passed by the British Parliament, that is final. In India, it is not final. It is subject to assent of the president. Sometimes president can ask the states to reconsider or he can veto it. Or it can be struck down by the Supreme Court using the powers of judicial review. So in India, there is no parliamentary sovereignty. Next one, India is a federal system. UK is a unitary system. In UK, the states are not there. Center is all powerful, but in India, powers are distributed between the center and the states. UK follows rule of law. And rule of law is implemented through procedure established by law. But in India, there is a combination of procedure established by law as well as due process of law. What is procedure established by law? Procedure established by law means that fundamental right can be taken away just if there is a procedure and if the procedure is followed by the government, it's enough. That was the existing practice in India before 1980 Menaka Gandhi case. But in Menaka Gandhi case, there was a shift from due procedure established by law towards due process of law. Due process of law is taken from USA, where it is not only enough to have a procedure, the procedure will have to be just fair and reasonable. Just by having a procedure, fundamental right cannot be taken away. There has to be a justice, fairness in that procedure. Otherwise, it can be struck down by the Supreme Court using the power of judicial review. Okay, so these are the differences between Indian model and British model. So we addressed all the parts of question. Finally, conclusion. Conclusion is that India adopted the best practices of UK into its constitution, and it has been followed. But however, it was not blindly copied. It was based after due assessment of its suitability for India. This can be a conclusion. Okay. Anyone has any doubt on this? Okay, fine. If no doubts, then let me ask you a question. The question is, which article of Constitution provides for National Commission for Backward Caste? Wrong. Good, Kiran. So wrong, Sunil. Wrong, Praveen. Kiran is right. It's 338B. 338 deals with National SC Commission. National Commission for Scheduled Caste. 338A is National Commission for Scheduled Tribe. 338B is National Commission for Backward Caste. Okay, one more question. Why, through which constitutional amendment GST came into force? 101. Oh, Praveen, 1001. Okay. 102, 101. It's 101. Okay. There is unanimity in 101. Nice, all of you are active. Nice, 101. Okay. Fine. Let's move to the next question. List the parliamentary mechanisms available for scrutiny of regulators. Also discuss the major steps through which parliamentary oversight of regulators can be strengthened. What do you mean by regulator? RBI. In every sector, there is a regulator. Example, in banking sector, we have RBI. For the competition sector, there is Competition Commission of India. For telecom sector, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, TRAI. For the insurance sector, IRDAI, Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India. So for every sector, there will be a regulator. What is the... First, let us look at the question and then I'll come back to you. So list the parliamentary mechanisms available for scrutiny of regulators. So parliamentary mechanism we have to tell. That is first thing. Second, when discuss the major steps through which parliamentary oversight can be strengthened. Okay, that is the second part. So broadly, there are two parts. One, the first part, second part. Now, what can be our introduction? Our introduction, we can tell what is the need for scrutiny of regulators. They haven't asked it, but we can tell that in the introduction. The need is that the proper functioning of regulators will ensure that they fulfill their legal constitutional mandate. They deliver to the people the best of so that the best of services are received by the people. They ensure fair competition among all the stakeholders. So that is the need for scrutiny of regulators. And why parliamentary mechanism? Because parliament is the voice of the people. MPs are elected by the people. So it is the people who are indirectly holding the regulators for scrutiny. I'll give you an example as to why scrutiny is important. For example, we have TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. All of us are using mobile phones. Proper functioning of TRAI is required to ensure there is no call drop. The cost of making a call is very less. The cost of internet is very less. There is no unfair trade practice. So imagine if there was no TRAI, what would happen? Maybe they could charge us 100 rupees per GB of data. For one call, they could have charged us 10 rupees. It is because of TRAI that all these things cannot happen. Because of parliamentary scrutiny of regulators, best quality services will be delivered. Now let us arrive at the body. That is, list the parliamentary mechanisms available. What are the mechanisms available? One is we have department-related standing committee, DRSC. There are 24 department-related standing committee. For every department, there will be, usually for most departments, there is DRSC. So the DRSC, during its meetings, can look into the working of regulators. Example, Department of Telecom can look into TRAI. Next one, there is Public Accounts Committee, one of very strong committee. Both DRSC as well as Public Accounts Committee are joint committees. DRSC has 31 members. Public Accounts Committee has 22 members. Public Accounts Committee can use CAG reports to look into working of the regulators. Next, parliamentary committee meetings. In parliamentary committee meetings, the officials of regulators can be called to question and they can be asked as to how they are working. Next one, there is question hour, 0 hour, half an hour discussion. So many parliamentary mechanisms are there. In question hour, three types of questions can be asked: start question, unstart question, short notice question. Next, during passing of budget, there can be, during budget discussion, there can be question about, there can be scrutiny of regulator, questions about scrutiny of regulators. Then there can be special committees specifically set up for any purpose. Those committees can look into scrutiny of regulators. So these are the parliamentary mechanisms. First part of the question is addressed. Second part of the question says, is asking us, tell the steps through which it can, parliamentary oversight can be strengthened. So what does it indirectly mean? Why should, when will there be a need to strengthen something? Only if there is no enough scrutiny presently. Why there is no scrutiny presently? Our scrutiny is not effective. What are the reasons? Reasons are that the working of regulators is of complex nature. It requires domain expertise. But most of our MPs are generalist MPs. They are not experts in the field. Second one is there is resistance from the regulators to come under parliamentary scrutiny. Example, RBI governor was called for a parliamentary committee meeting. He told that I will not come. I'm not duty bound to come. Next one, our MPs have so much work to do. They have to look into their constituency. They have to look into political things. And they have very little time left for scrutiny of regulators. So duration of parliamentary sittings is very less. They sit for maybe around 100 days in a year. And within those 100 days, there are so many disruptions. There is very little time available for parliamentary scrutiny. Fourth one is there is no independent think tank which will advise the MPs. In USA, there is an independent think tank called Congress Research Office. That office will have few experts in various fields. Those experts will guide the MPs as to how work will have to be carried out. Such a body is not there in India. they will have to depend on their PAs presently. Now, coming to the what they asked, what are the steps for strengthening the oversight? One is we need parliamentary research office, an expert think tank similar to the one in USA, similar to the one in US Congress, which will give expert advice for our generalist MPs. Next one is these regulators will have to prepare annual reports. Every annual report of every regulator should be laid before the both houses. Presently, it is not mandatory. Third one, setting aside time for session, time during the session for discussion, during the meetings. When they decide what the business of the session should be, they should set aside some time for discussion about the regulators. So this is how you strengthen parliamentary oversight on the regulators. And final conclusion is that proper functioning of regulators is very important to ensure that the market economy which we adopted after 91 becomes a success. It is inclusive. So hence, parliamentary scrutiny over it should be strengthened so that it fulfills its mandate. Okay. That is how you write that answer. Anyone? Any question? Because no questions, then I'll give you my question. Which is the regulator for the capital markets in India? First, SEBI, okay, good. Okay, is there, I'll come to your questions, Agar, wait. My second question to you guys. Which is the act which governs Competition Commission of India? When was it passed? Sagar. Okay, CCI Act 2002. It's not CCI Act. No, Sunil, it's not Companies Act. And RTI, no, Ashwini. Okay, it's not CCI Act. It's just Competition Act. So it's just CA, Competition Act 2002. It was passed in 2002. Before, passed, not in 2003, it was in 2002. Before that, we had MRTP Act, Monopolistic and Restrictive Trade Practices Act. That was a body which we had after independence for many years. But that body was not working well. It was restricting the development of the private sector. So the government replaced that with a new Competition Act, which provided for a Competition Commission of India. Okay. Next, we will move on. Regulation. Yeah, there is a provision. If they're not working well, they can be taken to court, High Court, Supreme Court, and they can give whatever orders they need. Okay, Sagar? Fine. I'll move on. Next question. Explain the need for transparency transparency in political funding in India. Do you think electoral bonds can help solve the problem pertaining to lack of transparency in political funding? Good question, interesting question. So first, let us look what are the parts. Explain the need for transparency in political funding. This is one first part. Next part is about electoral bonds. Can it help solve the problem of lack of transparency in political funding? So this is the second part. There are two parts. One more thing is, whenever there are two parts, give equal importance for each part. If there are two parts, 50-50%. If there are three parts, for each part, 33%. It should not be like one part you write two lines, other part you write 10 lines. Both carry equal weightage. First question is, political funding. What do you mean by political funding? Political funding means, how do the political parties receive their funds? What is the source of their funds? What is the source of their funds? It can be by the leaders of political parties themselves. Second, it can be given by the workers of political parties. It can be donated by the public. It can be donated by the corporates. So these are the various sources of political funding. Now, what is the need for transparency? Need for transparency is that free and fair elections are the hallmark of democracy. For free and fair elections, it should be ensured that there is no misuse of money power. By bringing transparency in political funding, use of money power will come down in elections. That is first point. Second point, black money is flushed into politics. In fact, black money is widely used in almost every election. So transparency in political funding will reduce the problem of black money. Third, it will reduce crony capitalism. What is crony capitalism? If there is no transparency, what will the industrialist do? Industrialist will say, I have to a political party, I will give you 10 crore rupees. Once you come back to power, you have to give me a project worth 100 crore rupees. That is crony capitalism. By bringing transparency, people will know who has donated to whom, so they can ensure accountability on the government. So it will reduce crony capitalism. Also, citizen enjoy Article 19, right to information, Article 19.1a. I have the right to information, right to freedom of speech and expression comes right to information. So under right to information, I have the right to know as to how political parties receive their funds. Finally, it is important for intra-party democracy. Because if there is no transparency, the political bosses, the high command will have all the power. If there is transparency, everyone will have their due share of power. And if you look at 2019 elections, more than 40% of our Lok Sabha MPs have criminal case against them. What is the reason? There is a linkage between criminalization and lack of transparency in political funding. If there is transparency, then clean candidates will come to power. If clean candidates come to power, criminalization in politics will end. One more thing is, transparency in political funding is important to ensure, is important to attract good people to electoral politics. Today, you and me cannot contest in an election. The cost of elections are very high. There is need for crores of rupees because there is lack of transparency. If there is transparency, then political parties will have less illegal money. If there is less illegal money, good people like you tomorrow might contest elections. So that is the need for bringing transparency in political funding. Okay, now that we have established that there is need for transparency in political funding, what measures have been taken? One measure is, earlier, 3 years ago, up to 20,000 rupees, there could be anonymous donation. What is anonymous donation? Political parties could say that I received cash, but we don't know who gave the cash. That was possible. So what was happening? Most of the political parties were getting most of their political funding from anonymous donations. The problem is no one knows from where the money came. It could be black money also. In most of the cases, it was black money. In fact, those national parties got more than 50% of their funding through anonymous sources. What did the government do? Government brought that limit from 20,000 to 2,000 rupees. Government said that more than 2,000, you have to disclose who the donor is. Less than 2,000, you don't have to disclose who the donor is. But political parties are smart. What the political parties do? They divide the 20,000 rupees into 1,999. So until that, we don't know who gave. So that has not been a success. That is one thing. Second one of transparency is, second thing, is they brought electoral bond scheme. What is electoral bond? Tomorrow, you can go to State Bank of India and buy an electoral bond, and you can deposit that electoral bond with a political party, and the political party will deposit in its account. People say that it is very good. What are the reasons? One reason is that you cannot use cash for electoral bond, and most of the political funding is through cash. The reason is cash cannot be traced. If it is online or in the check, then it can be traced. Donor will be known. So in electoral bond, there is no use of cash. You have to buy only using check or any other digital method. Second benefit is that political parties will have to deposit that electoral bond in their account in the same day in which they receive that electoral bond. Because of that, they cannot misuse that electoral bond for long. They will have to immediately encash it. Third one, in India, one problem is if tomorrow you go and give money to one party, the opposite party, if it comes to power, they will target you. Hence, people give anonymous donations. But now in electoral bond, no one knows, even the political party, no political party will know who gave money to whom. So there is secrecy in electoral bond. So these are the good things. But the question is not that. Question is, do you think it will solve the problem of transparency in political funding? It won't solve the problem of transparency, because even now, political parties which have received money from electoral bonds, the identity of the donor is not known to any person. So citizens' right to know is not there. Political parties' right to know is not there. It can lead to crony capitalism, because there can be a tacit understanding between the donor and the political party. Fourth one, the government still can know who donated, because State Bank of India is a PSU, public sector undertaking. It comes under the government. So the government can know who donated to which political party. There is no secrecy as well. So at best, the election commission, the electoral bond scheme that will reduce the use of cash in political funding, it will not lead to transparency in political funding. So what is required for transparency? Totally doing away with cashless donations. Even electoral bond should be done away with, as told by the Election Commission of India in Supreme Court. There is a case presently happening in Supreme Court where Election Commission said that we are against electoral bonds. That is second one. And if political parties, it should be mandatory for them to disclose the identity of their donors. And if they do not disclose, then there should be a provision in Representation of People's Act to cancel their registration. So through these methods, we can bring transparency. So electoral bonds, can it solve the problem? Answer is no. And before that, you have to tell what is electoral bonds. They are bearer denominated bonds. They purchased through non-cash means, KYC compliant account. It can be purchased only from a KYC compliant account in denomination of 1,000 rupees to 1 crore rupees. It can be, it cannot be punished, purchased at all times of the year. It can be purchased only in some time scale. Finally, reasons why it will not solve the problem: there is no information of donors, nexus between party and donor, cash. It will lead to elimination of cash, not to elimination of transparency. And government controls State Bank of India, hence unequal playing field. And also, Election Commission of India in its affidavit in Supreme Court has spoken about against electoral bonds. Finally, way forward, we need to promote transparency in political funding. We have to bring political parties under RTA Act, and we have to remove this anonymity clause of 2,000 rupees. Finally, penal action against political parties if they are not disclosing the identity of their donors. That is what has to be done for bringing transparency in electoral funding. Anyone has any doubt with this question? What is the maximum limit of electoral bond? You can give any amount, but the bond will be only of 1 crore rupees maximum. You can give 10 crore rupees also, but then you'll have to buy 10 bonds. Okay, Praveen. what is the purpose for government allowing keep funding anonymous even with 2,000 rupees? What is the purpose? Because there are so many poor people in India. If you go to the villages, they still do not have an account. How will they give you money through? That person might be willing to give money to a political party, but he does not have an account. So he might give it through cash. But anonymous, yes, it should not be made anonymous. That is the argument. Why has the government kept it? It is because it will suit all political parties. In fact, all political parties are happy with anonymous donations. That is the reason. So electoral bonds have validity of 15 days, Alba. Yes, Praveen. I think they have validity of 15 days. I'll correct myself. I told it has to be deposited in the same day. I think it has to be deposited within 15 days. Thank you, Praveen, for correcting me. Okay, let me ask you a question. The question is, how many national parties are there in India presently? Seven? Anyone with a different answer? Eight, I guess. Anyone with a different answer? Five? Anyone with eight? Okay. The answer is, even I don't know. That's your question. You guys find out and let me know whenever we meet next time. Any idea about how many political parties are there in India? How many registered political parties are there in India? Anyone? Eight political parties. No, Suchitra. There are more than 1,000 political parties in India, 2,000 plus. Yes. Good, Ashwita. There are so many political parties. In fact, many people open political parties not for contesting elections, but to manage their black money. Because if you start a political party, you get number of benefits. That is, whatever donations you make into it are tax exempted. Election. In fact, many people will come forward and register political parties. They will not have any voting percentage, but still they get the benefits. I think I missed the fifth question. Okay. Next question. It is of paramount importance to ensure that the Election Commission of India be fully insulated from political pressure to maintain purity of elections. In this context, discuss the need to have a relook at the process of appointment and removal of election commissioners to the Election Commission of India. So here, they're saying that it's of paramount importance. What is importance? To maintain election commission's independence is paramount importance. So that should be our introduction. Second part is, in this context, discuss the need. This is the crux of the question. Discuss the need to have a relook at the process of appointment and removal of election commissioners. Okay, very interesting question. Election commission. So what should we write? We should first tell, give a brief background about Election Commission. Election Commission creates a constitutional body under Article 324 of the Constitution. It's a bulwark of democracy. It is to ensure free and fair elections in India. Give a brief background about Election Commission. Now, next part of the question. What is the need for an independent Election Commission? Why should we have an independent Election Commission? The reason is democracy is based on free and fair elections. For free and fair elections, there has to be a neutral umpire. Who is the neutral umpire in India? It is the Election Commission. If there is no neutral umpire, imagine what will happen in a cricket match. Only one team will win. Hence, for free and fair elections, we need an independent Election Commission. Second one, for success of democracy, there is need for independent Election Commission. Third one, for ensuring people's faith in the voting system, for people's faith in the democracy, there is need for independent ECA. If there is no independent ECA, tomorrow people will not come and vote. Voting percentage will further fall. Also, a need for independent Election Commission. Internationally, India is respected because Election Commission conducts the biggest election process in the world. Nowhere in the world we have more than 80 crore voters. In fact, I think it's 90 crore in the 2019 election. Many other countries come to Election Commission for guidance as to how to conduct the elections. So it's a part of our soft power. More greater is the independent Election Commission, greater is our soft power. That is the need for an independent ECI. Next part, main crux of the question is, there is a need for relook at the process of appointment and removal of election commissioners. This is the question. Why there is a need for relook? One thing is, who appoints the election commission member, chairman, and chief election commissioner and other election commissioners? It is appointed by the president on the advice of the executive. What is the problem? In a cricket match, I think, assume that one party will decide the umpire. What will happen? What kind of umpire will they elect, will they appoint? They will appoint an umpire who will always favor them. So that is one problem. It leads to conflict of interest, executive appointment. Second one, after appointment, there is no security of tenure for the election commissioners. There is security of tenure for chief election commissioner. To remove the chief election commissioner, he or she is removed along the lines of a Supreme Court judge. It's very difficult. It's similar to the impeachment process. But however, removal of chief election commissioner can be done by the president just with the concurrence of the election commissioner, of the chief election commissioner and the government. So there is no security of tenure for our election commissioners. What will that lead to? The election commissioners will become puppets in the hands of the government of the day, whichever government it is. So that is no security of tenure except for chief election commissioner. And also there is no bar on future appointments under the government. That is, tomorrow chief election commissioner can be given any other constitutional post. This will affect the working, free and fair working of election commissioners, because they might come under the influence of the government. Government can influence them using this weight of future appointments. Hence, there is a need for relook at the process. What are the reforms needed? The reforms that are very simple. A manner of appointing NHRC chairman or a CBI director. That is, there has to be a committee appointment where there is a representation from the legislature, that is the speaker, from the executive, that is the government, from the opposition, that is the leader of opposition or the leader of the largest party of the opposition. So there has to be a committee-based appointment or a collegium appointment. Next one, removal of EC should be similar to CEC. Chief election commissioner, election commissioner's powers are the same. Hence, the removal method will also have to be the same. There has to be security of tenure for the other election commissioners. There has to be a bar on future appointments. That is, once if you are an election commissioner, you cannot have any other post in the government. Next one, at least there can be a cooling off period. That is, once you retire from election commission, at least 5 years you cannot take up any other post. This will reduce the probability of government influencing the election commission. Finally, there has to be financial independence. Presently, if you look at UPSC, expenditure of UPSC is charged, not votable by the legislature, by the Lok Sabha. But financial commission does not have this independence. Its expenditure, government will have to agree for the expenditure. We have to give financial independence along the lines of other parties like Supreme Court, UPSC. Finally, conclusion. There has been rising questions about credibility of the election commission. The above mentioned changes are quintessential to ensure credibility of the election commission of India and credibility of the democracy in India. That can be the conclusion. Okay. Anyone has any doubt? Someone is silent today. Sanjana is silent. Prajwal. Any doubt? No? Okay, fine. Then I'll ask you a doubt. Okay, Dinesh Goswami committee reforms. Okay, there are a number of... Okay. Why can't political party? Okay, Sunil, why can't political party come under RTA? That is one question. We will deal with it in the in another 10-15 minutes. And someone asked, what was that question? Dinesh Goswami committee reforms. Okay, there were a number of committees for reform of election commission. One was Dinesh Goswami committee. Then we had 2-3 committees. That exactly I don't know what the reforms were, but all of them spoke about giving independence for the election commission, making election commissioners on par with the chief election commissioner, independent cadre of officials to the election commission, giving powers to the election commission to disqualify parties for violation of norms, giving statutory backing for the model code of conduct. These were a few of the recommendations given by most of the committees, and Dinesh Goswami committee, by and large, would have given the same things. Okay, my question is, who was the most famous chief election commissioner? Session, Sunil Arora. Session. Okay, it was TN Session. Correct, right guys, TN Session. In fact, every institution, there'll be so many people who come and go, but we remember very few of them. In election commission also the same. There are so many election commissioners, we hardly remember the names of few, but TN Session, a name stands out. I think he passed away because of COVID, if I'm right. Last year, I think he passed away. One member, in fact, that time, election commission was a single body. Single member body. There was only chief election commissioner. There were no election commissioners at all. Okay, one more interesting story for you guys. Earlier, the election commission had only a commissioner. There are no other election commissioners. It was a one member body. But however, TN Session was a power. He used the powers of election commission to bring free and fair elections. He curbed use of money power, curbed use of muscle power, curbed booth capturing, use of violence during elections. He curbed all these things. So the government got worried about the election commission. They thought, now how to control this election, this TN Session. One, we cannot remove him because there is security of tenure for that person. He will have to be removed by the legislature, difficult process. Then how to control him? We will make an election commission three-member body, and decision will be taken on a 2-1 basis. That is, if two of them agree, then we can. The other can't do much. So they make it a three. They made it a three-member body, and their intention was appointing two other people who will take the power of TN Session. That was the story behind it. Okay, we'll move on to the next question. And but someone asked some question. Any international examples that we can adopt from? Any international examples? Sorry, I don't know about any international examples, but if you ask me for suggestions, I can give you 2-3 suggestions. One is internationally, I think Japan is exploring as to how blockchain can be used for election. I think already they're using Japan. So if they use blockchain, it will reduce many problems like proxy voting, one person voting multiple times, and instead of going to the booth and voting, we can directly vote from our homes. So many issues will be addressed. So blockchain, that is one thing which can be explored. I'll give one more interesting thing. One more interesting thing is many people do not vote in elections. One reason is that they're indifferent. Second reason is that they will have to travel back to their villages to vote. Imagine there are 30-40% people of India who are migrants. They reside in one area, but they're registered in another area. All people are not rich like you and me. They cannot go and just for the sake of election, they cannot spend one day, 2 days, spend hundreds of rupees going back to their villages and voting. That is the reason why people are not participating in the voting process. One reform is that every person should be given the right to vote without much difficulty. That is one reform which is very much required. Okay, unless people are educated, mass awareness, long-term harmful effects on how voting for cash, any changes to the appointments is not so worthy, I guess. Yes, what you told is, Shavan, it is true, Shavan, but whatever you told, awareness generation among people, making people more ethical, moral, that's a long-term process. That long-term process is very time-consuming, more energy-consuming. In the mean that what you told should be done, but in the meantime, if we reform election commission, then it will be a progress towards change. Suddenly overnight, India will not become a beautiful democracy. It is through small changes in all dimensions through which we can become a beautiful country. Sir, can we issue card, like one card, one nation, so people can vote? Yes, we can issue one card, one nation, one card. In fact, presently also we have one nation, one card only. We have the same card, voting card. But the problem is with respect to EVMs, Suchitra. In EVMs, presently EVMs are not connected to internet. They are not connected through any other methods. So if you have to press that EVM, you have to go there only and press. From Bangalore, I cannot press an EVM which is there in Mysore. That is the problem, Suchitra. One voting card. one voting card. Yes, Kiran, we have only one voting card only given by the election commission. There are no multiple voting cards. But using that voting card, how will you go and press that button? So for that, either we have to move away from, either we have to connect the EVMs to internet or something, but there are problems of connecting with internet. One cyber crime, someone can manipulate it's within India and outside, from outside India, it can be manipulated. That is the problem. One nation, one rule. I think she means interoperability from a different city also. I think if you are talking about interoperability, then you are, what you're saying is right. Okay. Give me a minute. I need to take a phone call. Okay, I'm sorry for the delay. Okay, we'll continue. Otherwise, we can't complete the paper. But I'm happy that all of you are participating. So making digital voting possible. Yes, Pramod, we should make it possible. But there are problems also. That is why the government is not making it happen. We have to find some method. And digital has more problems. One thing, they have to come up with some other mechanism. Okay, nice guys. I'm sure that with this interest, you will go to many places. You're able to hear me, no? Confirm us? Okay, yes, okay. Fine. And next question, seventh question. Okay, we are running late. I want to complete it before 9. Discuss the need for an effective and functional working relationship between Gram Panchayat and SHGs. How can efficient synergy between the two be achieved? Okay, good question. This, there are two parts of the question. This is one part. Discuss the need for a working relationship between Gram Panchayats and SHGs. That is the first part. Second part is, how can the efficient synergy between the two, synergy is nothing but a relationship, good relationship between the two, how can it be achieved? So for this, you need to know what is a Gram Panchayat. Gram Panchayat is the lowest level of in the three-tier Panchayat system created by 73rd Amendment Act. What are SHGs? SHGs are a group of 15-20 people who come together for mutual help, self-help. Other characteristics of SHGs are, more than 90% of SHGs are made of women. Second, there are people of same socio-economic background. That is, there won't be SHG where one person is too rich, one person is too poor. Third one, they're a group of 15-20 people, not very huge, 10-15-20, that's it. Fourth one, it is based on mutual help, collective help, self-help. Now, question is not about Gram Panchayat and SHGs. Question is asking about, what is the need for an effective, functional working relationship? The need for the effective functioning relationship is that both Gram Panchayat and SHGs will benefit because of this relationship. How one is SHGs can hold the Gram Panchayat accountable because of this working relationship. So there will be less corruption in the Gram Panchayat, greater accountability, transparency in the Gram Panchayat. Next one, SHGs, they're mostly, I told you, more than 90% of SHGs in India are women. In fact, more than 95%. So the because of this association with SHGs, Gram Panchayat will become more gender inclusive. They'll come with gender inclusive actions. Next one, SHGs benefit from Gram Panchayat. Also, SHGs are beneficiaries because Gram Panchayat programs, activities, they can benefit out of it. Example, if Gram Panchayat decides to make sanitary pads for women and give it to school children, they want to buy a costly sanitary pad from the market, but instead they can give the contact to SHG. SHG will manufacture at a very cheap price. So SHG is also benefited, Gram Panchayat is also benefited, people are also benefited. Next one, Gram Panchayats give a political voice to SHGs. SHGs are presently, there are multiple small SHGs. They don't have political voice. Through association with Gram Panchayat, which is a political body, they'll get greater political voice. Also, Gram Panchayat is an implementing agency for so many programs. Through these working relationships, SHGs can be aware about the various government programs, various avenues for development. They will have greater business opportunities. Next one, link between SHGs and Gram SHGs and urban local bodies. I don't know what I've written. I forgot. Next one, communication on government programs. Okay. Gram Panchayats, as I told you, they are the implementing agencies for various programs. So the SHGs will get awareness about the government's programs. So that is the need for a working relationship. First part is addressed. 50% of the answer is done. Second part is, how can an efficient synergy between the two be achieved? How can it be achieved? One thing is, Gram Panchayats in its meetings can call SHG members to participate in that. Next one, they can create an online platform where SHGs can communicate with Gram Panchayats about their problem faced, what they expect. Gram Panchayats can communicate to them the various programs, schemes where SHGs can participate. That is second one. Next one, SHG members can go and participate in the Gram Sabha meetings and thereby participate with the Gram Panchayats. Next one, for all actions, work done by the Gram Panchayats, social auditing by SHGs can be made mandatory. That will ensure, that will foster a better relationship. The Gram Panchayat can maintain a database of all SHGs and the details of all the members of the SHGs. I told about online virtual connect, and you can give various suggestions of your own if you have any. And in the conclusion, we can talk about the Kerala's Kudumbashree model, where it's a excellent case study of success of SHG because of association with Gram Sabha. And you can, in between, you can give examples of other SHGs also which are famous. For example, one is Lijjat Papad in Maharashtra, in the Bombay region, and there are so many other SHG. I think there is one in Bihar that's also famous. Okay, we'll move on. Okay, anyone has anything to ask in this question? Seva, Self-Employed Women's Association of Maharashtra. Seva is not an SHG. Seva is an NGO, Kiran. Seva is made up of, in fact, more than 10,000 women. SHG is a small body. Through social audit, correct, Vinod. So, Sagar had asked about... SC held that only independent persons and non-bureaucrats be appointed as state election commissioner, given that they are appointed by governors. It is a problem that serving is not only serving bureaucrats and not trade ones. Okay. One thing it's not about, yes, Sagar, you're right, but the question was about the chief, the central election commission, not the state election commissioner. So it was about from the center's perspective, not the state election commission perspective. Okay, Sagar? Anyone? Any doubt? No, we'll move on. Okay, I'll ask you one question. The reason for asking one question is I don't want to bore you. Otherwise, it'll become very boring, even for me and even for you. I believe in two-sided communication, not just one. Okay, the question about SHG and Gram Panchayats. Okay, what is the age of contesting in a Gram Panchayat election? Minimum age? 21. Okay, so you guys are fast. Good. An important aspect. And don't you think, I'll give you some food for thought. Think about it. For contesting in a Gram Panchayat or Taluk Panchayat or Zilla Panchayat, the age is, minimum age is 21 years. Or even for a BBMP election, it's 21 years for urban local bodies. But why do we? But for MLA MP elections, it is 25 years. Don't you think both of them will have to be the same? If I am capable of being a corporator, then why am I not capable of being an MLA? Don't you think this is, the difference is not logically feasible? Think about it. Okay, next we'll move on. An important aspect of curtailing corruption is to minimize the discretionary power available to government officers. Analyze. Also suggest ways in which this can be achieved. So, very, very interesting question. Corruption. Tomorrow you'll become government officers. How to tackle corruption? You need to know this. An important aspect of curtailing corruption is minimizing discretionary powers. So, that is first part. In fact, it's not a part. You have to, yes, you have to analyze it. Second one is, so that is one. Suggest ways in which this can be achieved. Two. There are two parts to the question. So 50-50%, you have to give a strong introduction, a strong conclusion, and talk 50% about that, talk 50% about this. That's it. You don't get 10 out of 10. The best you will get 6 marks, 7 marks out of 10. So, see, there is a direct correlation between discretionary power and corruption in government offices. Greater is the discretionary power, greater is the corruption. Lesser is the discretionary power, lesser is the corruption. Example, there are few departments where there is high corruption. Example, when you go to get a passport, there is less corruption. The reason is the passport officer will have to give you the passport. He cannot say no. But when it comes to a driving license, usually it is seen that corruption is more because the officer there has more discretionary power to disqualify you if you are, because he will look at your driving and he will say that no, if you don't pay him a bribe, he will say no, you don't know to drive, you made some mistake, and he will disqualify you. So there is a direct correlation between discretionary power and corruption. What will happen if there is less discretionary power? Imagine, example, in the case of the passport officer, the one who is giving passport. In corruption, I think there is only one level. In passport, there is only one place where there is corruption. That is finally when there is direct verification by the police. When they come home, usually it is seen that people bribe them. Apart from that, there is no corruption. So what will happen if there is less discretionary power? There will be less demand for bribe. Imagine that passport officer sitting there has no discretion at all. Can he ask for a bribe? No. He cannot make any demand for a bribe. Second one, since he has no discretion, will the bribe giver go and give him bribe? Will you go and give him bribe? You will say, why should I give a bribe? Give me my passport. Because you know that passport will anyways come. So there will be less incentive for the bribe giver to give bribe. Whenever you have to tackle corruption, you have to tackle the supply of corruption and demand of corruption. So when you reduce discretionary power, demand side will come down, supply side of corruption will also come down. Hence, corruption will come down. And also decisions, if there is less discretionary power, decisions will be based on rules, procedures, not on whims and fancies of the officer. Example is, in transport demand department, Janagraha, an NGO, did a study where they saw that earlier, even for learner's license, there was discretion on the part of the official to give you a learner's license. But now in Karnataka transport department, for learner's license, you just have to pass a test. Well, they'll ask you 15 questions. If you get more than 50 or 60%, you will get learner's license. So because of that, there was decrease of corruption because there was decrease of discretionary power that was seen. First part is addressed. First part we have analyzed as to why reducing discretionary power will reduce corruption. We have satisfactorily established that. Now, second part is how to reduce discretionary power. That is the next question. If you see, in fact, if you go to income tax department, now there is less number of people fear the income tax department. The reason is the discretionary power of income tax officers has come down. Everything is faceless there. They won't even know whom they are assessing. Everything is online. So using information communication technology, you can make it, you can reduce the discretionary power. Example is faceless IT assessment. Next one, if there is no policy, rule, regulation, then the officer can do whatever he wants. He can make it, he has a discretion. But if there are clear rules, unambiguous rules, regulations, policies, guidelines, then there is less scope for corruption. Next one is artificial intelligence. How artificial intelligence I'll give you an example. Coal block allocations. Before 2013, they were alleging coal scam where officials were prosecuted. Two IAS officers went to jail because there was allegation that they misused their discretionary power. Instead, all coal block allocations are online. The computer will decide where you just quote your bids. Whoever is the lowest bid, the computer will only decide. Use of artificial intelligence. Next one, if 1%, if you give the decision to 1%, then discretionary power is more. But if it is collegial decision making, then there will be less scope for corruption. Assume tomorrow I give power to Kiran. Kiran, if I tell Kiran, you decide who should get the coal license, coal mining license, then discretionary power has been given to him. He might take bribe and give the coal block. But if I tell all of you, Kiran, I'm not getting the names. What are your names? Pramod, Kusuma, Ashish. If I tell all of you people will be part of a committee who will decide coal block allocation, then there is less scope for corruption because difficult for collective corruption. All of you, it's difficult to bring all of you on board. So there will be objective decision. Okay, that is collegium decision making while awarding contracts. But conclusion is that it is impossible to eliminate discretionary power. Don't you agree? Because discretionary powers are necessary for good governance. Because governance, good governance calls for decisions based on the prevailing situations on the ground. For making a decision based on prevailing situation on the ground, there is need for discretionary power. If you want good governance, there is need for some discretionary power. Hence, it is impossible to eliminate. It is necessary. So what will have to be done? One is, as much as possible, discretionary power should be reduced. The second thing is, you have to select the right kind of officials, right kind of persons for the right job so that they do not misuse their discretionary power. And you need to create mechanisms like transparency, strong anti-corruption agencies, whistleblower protection should be strong to ensure that even if there is misuse, there is prosecution and thereby deterrence is created. That should be the conclusion. Okay. Any doubts on this? Okay, Shravan, what you say is accepted by government. That is why the present policy is like that. But then you can also say that for MLA, it's 25 years, then make MP 30 years because this is still school. Yeah, becoming an MP is like a college. So that argument can be given. But you can give argument after argument. But I agree with you. Okay. Fine, Shravan. Good. Can we move on? Anyone has any question? Okay. Do you think Lokpal effective? Okay. Sunil, actually Lokpal has not been fully created at all. The act was passed in 2013, but only the Lokpal has been announced. The body and its members have not yet been created. So till now, it has not yet been created at all. Hence, it is neither. We cannot call it either effective or ineffective. It is inexistent. Okay, fine. Let me ask you something. Which are the two most holiest places for Muslims? Makkah. Very good, Shravan. Makkah. I asked two. Okay, Medina. Which is the third holiest place for Muslims? Third holiest place. Makkah, Jerusalem, Al-Aqsa Mosque. Okay, good. The third holiest place is Al-Aqsa Mosque. That's there in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is a place which is very important. Within 1 square kilometer area, you have three of the most holiest places of the world. One for Judaism, one for Christianity, one for Islam. That is Al-Aqsa Mosque. That is why all this conflict is happening. Every day would be looking at news of Israel, Hamas conflict, that is the issue. That's in fact, one of the most complex problem where there is religion, where there is communalism, there is regionalism, there is ethnicity, there is foreign politics, there is power politics, regional politics. Issue goes back to First World War, Second World War. One of the most complex problem you can think of. See, imagine Ayodhya, there are only two religions, there is so much fighting. Imagine that Ayodhya was claimed by another third religion also. Imagine the complexity of the problem. That is the problem there. Okay, we'll move on. Okay, public service delivery in India. Public service delivery, running water to your homes by BBMP. Next, electricity. Food through PDA shops. All that is public service delivery. Has long been marred by various issues. Various issues. Leading to poor service delivery outcomes. Leading to poor service delivery outcomes. While discussing the reasons for the same, suggest ways to make public service delivery more efficient. So two parts. This is one part. Discuss the reasons for the same. First part. Second part is the suggest ways to make public service delivery more efficient. Okay. In India, if you see, most of you are not going to government schools. You are not going to government hospitals. Many rich people are buying bisleri cans. They are not depending on government supply of water. Many of them have UPS in their homes because they don't want to depend on the government for electricity. There is a flight towards the market in India where people are dissatisfied with public service delivery of the government. They are not trusting the public service delivery systems, and hence there is a flight towards the market. We are depending on the market for our services. Indians are depending less and less on government education, government healthcare, because of the poor service delivery. So now we have established that, yes, there is poor public service delivery in India. That is why people are going. This is the trend. After we have established the trend, let us look at the reasons for the same. What are the reasons? The reasons is poor state capacity. Example, to provide health in a government hospital, there is need for doctors. But there are no doctors in India. Example, doctor population ratio for... We need one doctor for 1,000 people according to WHO, but in India, there is only one doctor for 1,650 people. So there is poor state capacity. We do not have funds, we do not have finances, we do not have so many issues. Next is illiteracy and poverty. Because of illiteracy and poverty, people cannot hold the government accountable. Since people cannot hold the government accountable, there is poor service delivery. Next one is infrastructure issues. It can be physical infrastructure, financial infrastructure, ICT infrastructure. Financial infrastructure, government does not have money, hence they cannot provide you the best quality services. Physical infrastructure, that is the government does not have roads, rail, etc. Hence the food grains which are provided are of poor quality. Hence the food grains are of poor quality in the PDA shops. Next one, with respect to ICT infrastructure, there is no internet, because of which there is no tele-education. Hence, in the remote areas, the students have to bear the problem of a poor quality teacher teaching them. Had there been internet, there would be possibility of tele-education. The best teacher from the best part of India could be teaching those children. Next one, there is last mile connectivity issues. Example, banking correspondent. The government has provided for DBT, many people are not able to access it because there are no banking correspondents. Next, there is corruption, red tapeism. Because of corruption, you can see that the funds are eaten by the officials. Hence, the quality of service delivery comes down. Next one, monopoly. In many areas, government acts as a monopoly. Whenever government acts as a monopoly, there is no competition for the government. Government will become lackadaisical and there will be poor quality. Next one, low awareness amongst people. Now, what are the ways to tackle it? The ways to tackle it are that we need the market to compete with the government so that the government will compete and there will be better quality services. I'll give an example. Now, people have no option because the government says that you can buy only from PDA shop if you want ration. Government can give you an option. Government can say that either you come to us, we will give you 5 kg food grains, or we will give you money. We won't give you money. We will give you a food coupon. Using the food coupon, you can buy and go and buy in a supermarket. What will the people do? Wherever quality is better, they will go there. If quality is better in a government PDS, they'll go there, PDS shop. If quality is better in supermarket, they will go there. If people start going to supermarket, then government will realize that reforms are needed and they'll be forced to reform. So there is need for greater role for market. Next one, there's need for social audit. What is social audit? Audit of the service delivery by the people themselves. That is social audit. Next one, citizens. We need to pass Citizens' Right to Public Service Delivery Act. Example like the one we have in Karnataka, Sakala Act. Through that, there will be better public service delivery. Next, Citizen Charter. What is Citizen Charter? Citizen Charter is a document prepared by the government agency guaranteeing minimum quality of service delivery for the people. Next one, we need cooperative federalism. That is, center and the state should cooperate with one another to provide the best quality services. Next, there is need for competitive federalism. What is competitive federalism? We need to make the states to compete with each other. Again, I told you, if all forms of competition are good. Whenever there is competition, there will be the best coming out of each of them. So if we make the states compete, if the central government ranks the states, imagine what will happen. Tomorrow, Karnataka will come first and Tamil Nadu will come last. Tamil Nadu will think that, oh my God, I am last. I have to make some improvement in my public service delivery. Otherwise, there will be loss of face. People won't vote in the next election. So they will be forced to change, forced to reform. So we need competitive federalism. Next one, we have to improve the state capacity. Next, we need to, how to improve state capacity? Credits collection. Creation of more number of teachers, doctors, all that. Next, Sevottam model has been given by second ARC. For public service delivery, we need to adopt that model. We need to use the service of SHGs. We need to use information communication technologies. Finally, conclusion is that we can conclude by saying that, see, public service market cannot deliver all the needs of the people. Market can only deliver the needs of the has. Hence, the government should focus on improving its own service delivery, public service delivery standards, so that the have-nots also get their fair share of services which are due to them. That can be the conclusion. Okay? Anyone has any doubt? Anyone? No? Okay, one question. The question is, what do you think is the population of Israel? Anyone? 18 lakh, 5 crore, 90 lakh? Okay, 60 lakh, Rahul comes closest, 90 lakh, it's around 1 crore. In fact, less than the population of Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, Chennai, such a small country, imagine just one crore people, that country has gone to 3 wars with the Arab countries, powerful countries, Saudi Arabia, Iran, with all these countries, and in all the 3 wars, it won. Size does not matter. That is what it shows. Okay. We'll move on next one. In post-liberalist India, it is clear that the state player are not one of a regulator. Analyze. So there's only one part to the question. There are no multiple parts. So it has been simple. What is post-liberalist India? Before 1991, there was a pre-liberalist India, where the state dominated the economic space. But because of 1991 balance of payment crisis, from close to socialism, we went towards capitalism. We adopted liberalization, privatization, globalization. What is close socialism? But there is pre-1991 phase where we did not allow the private sector to function. There was only the government. Then there was suspicion on the private sector. Why we were not allowing the private sector to develop? Because we thought that the private sector is bad. They're corrupt. They're corrupting. Only the government will have to do everything. But then there was the LPG reforms, 1991, because of which that's free market. We moved towards free market. But still, the suspicion which was there that time still continues. The same suspicion continues. Hence, the state, instead of being that of a regulator, instead of being that of a facilitator, is still a regulator. What do you mean by a regulator? Regulator means someone who will prevent you from doing something. That's a negative role. Facilitator is someone who has an enabling role, a positive role. Okay, that is the difference between a regulator and a facilitator. Facilitator is more like a friend who will encourage you. A regulator is someone like a, imagine a tough father who is preventing you from doing something. That is a regulator. So state should be like a friend for the industry, not like a father who will dictate what to do. Example, I'll give you an example. For example, to construct a apartment in India, you have to take clearances from more than 24 different departments, authorities. Imagine 24 clearances. Now, what is the need for a facilitator state? Need is, it lead to development of private sector. It lead to better service delivery for the people. Less scope for corruption. Because there will be lesser rules and regulations, lesser outdated laws. It lead to ease of doing business. It will attract the FDI. It will attract the domestic investments. It lead to greater trust, cooperation, a healthy relationship between the state and the private sector. And also there was a study which said that if you trust someone, they will behave in a trustworthy manner. If you always doubt someone, they will behave in a doubtful manner. For example, tomorrow, once you become parents, if you trust your kid and give him 100 rupees, ask him to use it responsibly, then you will think twice before buying a cigarette. But if you don't trust him, then if he gets 100 rupees, he won't bother much about morals, ethics. He will just go and buy a cigarette. So if you trust, begets trust. If you trust, people will behave in a manner which is trustworthy. So always you should trust people. Then finally, however few steps have been taken recently towards making a state a facilitator. That is minimum governance, maximum governance given by your prime minister, color coding of industries where they divided the industry into four types, green, orange, white, green, orange, red. If you are a green industry, you don't have to take permission. That's a facilitator. Next one, RBI, SEBI, such regulators have dual role. One is that of a regulator, other is that of a facilitator in the statutes itself. Finally, we can conclude that we can give suggestions that there has to be every regulatory authority should be made into a facilitator. There has to be audit into its functioning every 5 years. Final conclusion is, we had first generation reforms in 1991, but presently we need second generation liberalization reforms where state is a facilitator, and that will ensure that we reached $5 trillion economy by 2025, which is a dream of our prime minister. That can be the conclusion. Any doubts? No doubts. Okay. No, Suchi. Okay. Thank you, Suchitra. Okay. Rahul Nayak. Okay. I'll tell you something interesting. In fact, last year, explain steps once again. Okay, Praveen, I'll do that. Where am I? Color coding of industries, wherefore if you are green industry, white industry, you don't have to take any permission. That is nothing but the state is acting as a facilitator. RBI, SEBI in their act, SEBI Act, RBI Act, they have dual role. One is the regulatory role, other is facilitator role. What is the way forward? Way forward is every regulatory authority should be made along the lines of RBI, SEBI, or facilitator also. Second one is, there has to be audit every 5 years about how the government or the regulatory authority is performing with respect to the industry. Is it a regulator? Is it a facilitator? If it's not a facilitator, what has to be done towards becoming a facilitator? Okay. These are the steps. Okay, Rahul, yes, there was a person with a word clear. I don't know which service. His name was Rahul Modi. Rahul Modi. They took one name from our both leaders, combined that. That was his name. Very funny. Okay. We'll move on. Next one, 9th one. We have a lot of work to do. I'll finish it by 9 o'clock. Highlight different alternate dispute resolution mechanisms available in India. I explain their importance also mentioned. So, this is the first part. Highlight it. Explain their importance. Second part, mention the different measures that have been adopted to further improve framework. Third part, three parts to the question. Give us good introduction, give a good conclusion. 33%. Done. Your answer is done. What is, first of all, alternate dispute resolution? If you have a dispute now, what most people do, they go to courts. Alternate dispute resolution means instead of going to court, settle it through some other means. That is alternate dispute resolution. What are the types? Types we have. Arbitration. What is arbitration? Both the parties will agree on an arbitrator. Tomorrow, if Rahul and Praveen have a dispute, they will appoint me as an arbitrator. The arbitrator, whatever award I give, that is binding on both of them. They cannot appeal it. That is called arbitration. Okay. Next, there is mediation. What is mediation? They will both same Rahul and Praveen. They have a dispute. They will appoint me as a mediator. What will I do? I will try to mediate between them. I will try to bring them closer. But I won't give any binding award. I cannot give binding award. Next one, conciliation. Happens in the case of, example, husband and wife, if they have a conflict, the court will ask them to go for conciliation. Where they will try to bring the parties together. They will not give any binding awards again. Next, there is Lok Adalat. What is Lok Adalat? Tomorrow again, Rahul and Praveen have a dispute. They will tell, let us go to a Lok Adalat. Lok Adalat is like a court. Similar to a court, it will have a judge or a senior lawyer. So Rahul will tell his problem. Praveen will tell his problem. And Lok Adalat will give an order. And the order of Lok Adalat is mandatory, binding. Next, Gram Nyayalayas. In villages, there will be problems, petty problems. Like, he stole my hen. That fellow stole my sheep. For that, we cannot go to Supreme Court. Supreme Court, it will be waste of time of Supreme Court. So in Gram Nyayalayas, they will set up where they will settle such petty disputes. In the rural areas, it was set up through Gram Nyayalaya Act. Now, the second part is importance. What is the importance of this ADR? The importance for people and the parties. Importance is for the people, for Rahul and Praveen, the cost of dispute, the cost of justice will come down. They don't have to pay lawyers. Time comes down. Instead of 15-20 years waiting in the courts, decision is given very fast. And there is a feeling of justice. Because there you cannot directly talk to a judge in a court, but here you can directly talk to whoever is the judiciary authority. Next, the benefits for the judiciary. Importance for judiciary is that there are more than 3.5 crore cases pending. It will lead to reduction of case pendency, reduction of burden on the judiciary. Second one, judiciary can look into more important decisions, more important things, not into very simple things. Next one, importance for the government. For the government also, government is also a party to many disputes. If they go for any of this, the burden on the government will come down. And also the government is the one which will have to look into all the law ministry will have to look into all these dispute matters. So the burden of the government will also come down. Next one, what has been done in the recent past for alternate dispute resolution in India? One is we had the Legal Services Authorities Act 1987, which provided for Lok Adalats. They are conducted more frequently now. Earlier, once in a while, it used to happen. Next one is a lot of awareness campaigns have been done by legal service authorities about ADR. Next one, we have an Arbitration and Conciliation Act. It's an old act, but it was amended in the year 2015 for making it more efficient. Because of this amendment, India's arbitration conciliation is on par with global standards. It is on par with the standards given by UNCITRAL, UN Commission for International UNCITRAL Trade Related. What is that? I don't know. Let me look into it. UNCITRAL. Okay, UN Commission for International Trade Law, if I'm right. So these are the things which has been done. UN Commission on International Trade Law. Yes, I was right. Next one, final conclusion. Way forward is the Law Commission suggestions about ADR will have to be implemented, and the global best practices will have to be looked into for greater penetration of ADR in India. That can be the conclusion. Okay, anyone has any doubt? Okay. No doubts? Difference between arbitration and reconciliation. It's not called reconciliation, it is called conciliation. In the conciliation, they cannot give binding award. In arbitration, it will be a binding award. For example, Kiran, you and Shravan have a problem, you come to me. In arbitration, whatever I tell you, have to listen. In conciliation, whatever I tell you, don't have to listen. Okay? I'll move on. Mediation also same like conciliation. Then yes, mediation and conciliation both are same, but there are very subtle differences between those two. That's why we just have a arbitration and conciliation act. We don't have an arbitration and conciliation mediation act. Okay. The question above of Praveen is then, what is the need of conciliation? What is the need of conciliation? I told you there are very subtle differences. Maybe if there is a lawyer, he'll be able to tell you. I don't know the exact subtle difference between that. Maybe I'll find out and let you know, Praveen. Okay. Or Tejas sir or Ritvik sir, you can ask them. They'll find out and let you know. We'll move on. Okay, Praveen. Fine. 12th one, freedom of religion cannot be allowed in a deny right quality and individual dignity. Very interesting. Discuss the in the light of constitutional provisions, recent judicial pronouncements. It's actually easy also, interesting also. See, we have right to freedom of religion. 27-28. Briefly, one line, you expand. Next, we have right to equality, right to individual dignity. Right to equality, 14-18. Mention 14, 15, 16. 16 is not important. 14, 15, only these two are important. Next one is 90 to 22. 19 is important. 21 is important. So explain these are important articles constitutionally. Then say that right to freedom of religion cannot be allowed to deny right to equality and individual dignity. Issues recently, Sabarimala, where they said that women of menstruating age can enter the temple and worship Lord Ayappa, because Article 14, 15 and 21 are very, very important. Next one, in Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan case, there is a very famous darga called Haji Ali Darga in Mumbai. It's very beautiful. Google the photo. In that darga, women are not allowed entry. So this a group of women under this name, Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan case, they went to the court. Supreme Court said that women will have to be allowed entry into Haji Ali Darga. Then there was Shani Singapur temple. I think it's in Pune, near Pune. In Shani Singapur temple, women were not allowed entry, similar to Sabarimala. Then they said that Bombay High Court said that women will have to be given entry. In all these cases, right to dignity of women was given importance over right to religion. In Santara case, what is Santara? Santara is a Jain practice where a person fasts until death. That is Santara. Where Supreme Court said that a person does not have the right to die and said that Santara is not an essential religious practice. Next one, in a case called Shirur Mutt case in the 1950s, Supreme Court spoke about essential religious practice, where they said that if something is essential religious practice, then we will allow it to continue. Otherwise, we will nullify it if it is violating any other fundamental right. Example is, they told in Sabarimala, they asked whether if not allowing women into a temple, is it an essential religious practice? Will anything happen to your religion if we remove this? They told, Supreme Court said that no, nothing will happen, so remove it. that is called essential religious practice. Next one, there was Shabana judgment in 1980s. Then there was Shaira Bano judgment. In Shabana judgment, Shabana was a woman, Muslim woman, who was divorced from her husband. Under Muslim law, alimony is maintenance is not given to woman by her husband after divorce. In Shabana case, Supreme Court said Muslim woman is also entitled to maintenance just like Hindu women because of Article 14, Article 15. There cannot be discrimination with respect to this. Next one, Shaira Bano judgment, abolition of triple talaq. Supreme Court said, again, Shaira Bano was the woman who was given triple talaq by her husband. Where Supreme Court said, Article 14, 15 should be given importance over right to religion. These are all the cases where right to religion was given less, could not suppress the right to dignity. Finally, we can conclude by saying that, okay, but however, there is one concern of this view of Supreme Court. One concern is that it is hurting public sentiments. It is hurting the religious sentiments of people. But however, we need to remember that religion is always subordinate to the dignity of a human being. If there is any part of religion which is violating the dignity of a human being, then there is need for social religious reform. We need to alter the religion to suit the interest of the human race. That is how progress can be achieved. Okay. That's about it. Anyone has any question? Anyone? No? Okay, Sujitra is saying no. No one has a question. Fine, then I will take my question. Question is, tell me a few practices which are still followed, which are violative of dignity of women. In the name of religion, it is practiced. Tell fast. Dawdi Bora Muslim, yes, Ashwini. In Dawdi Bora Muslim community, female genital mutilation is practiced. That is, they cut a part of the genitals of a woman to control her sexuality. They believe that if we do not cut that part of the genital, then it will lead to the woman becoming sexually experimental. Hence, they cut a part of the genitals. Very unhygienic, very, what do you say? I'm not getting the strong words. Highly condemnable practice. Women contemptible or any function during periods time. Very good, Praveen. Any function, yes. In fact, women are seen as inauspicious. Most of the homes it happens. During that time, for auspicious things, women are not encouraged. Regressive, heinous crime, yes. Any other practice, that's all. Women cannot become pujaris. Ashwini, good. That's also a thing. Very good. Polygamy practice is not allowed. No, my question is, polygamy practice is not allowed. That's a good thing. No, polygamy practice not being allowed. Sujitra.
Okay, Devdasi. Yes, but it has been made illegal. But there are a few things which have still not been made illegal.
White sari, shaved head after husband death. Okay, that's also good. Society will force on them entry of Parsi women married to non-Parsi. Very good, Pramod. Parsi women, the population of Parsis in India is declining. The reason is that the moment Parsi women marry a non-Parsi, then they lose their rights or ancestral property. Their children are no longer called Parsi. That is that is one regressive practice. Okay, fine. Also, one more regressive practice is sometimes Muslim women are forced to wear a burqa. Hindu women are forced to wear a veil. What is that called? Parda system. Still, these things continue. So many regressive practices still continuing.
Okay. We'll move on. Next question, 13th question.
Identify the key areas of reforms required in the judicial system in India. Okay, good question.
first part, this is the first part. A lawyer would be able to answer it better. In this context, examine the significance of AAJS. So only two parts. First, they're asking what are the reforms required in judicial system in India. Before that, we can tell what is the importance of judicial system in India. What is the importance to have an efficient judicial system? The importance is an efficient judicial system would lead to people getting justice speedily in a cost-effective manner. That is the importance of judicial system. Second one, what are the key areas of reforms required in the judicial system in India? Think what are the reforms required. One is we need to increase judge population ratio. Judge population ratio is very less in India. We have only around 18 judges for a million population. We need 50 judges for a million population according to UN. That is one thing. If we have less judges, we need more judges. Second thing is we need to increase the... We need to look into judicial appointments. Judicial appointments at the level of district judges is not made in a timely manner. We need to make it timely manner. Annually it has to be done, and also with respect to appointments to the High Court, Supreme Court, appointment will have to be made before a vacancy arises, not after a vacancy arises. Next one is we need to increase judicial accountability. Presently there is no law for ensuring judicial accountability. We need a judicial standards and accountability bill. That bill was introduced many times but was not passed. We need that for ensuring accountability. Next one, many states annual examinations are not conducted for recruitment for district judges. That will have to be ensured. Next one, AAJS, which we will discuss later. All India Judicial Service needs to be there, similar to IAS, IPS. For district judges, there is need for AAJS. Next one, not just courts, we need ADR. Just now we spoke, we need to promote ADR in India. Next one, legal education. The quality of legal education is very poor. The lawyers in India are not of very good quality. We need to increase the quality. We need Bar Council of India to take steps for increasing the quality of lawyers, because the quality of lawyers, if we improve quality of lawyers, then the parties will get better lawyers. Second thing is, lawyers only make judges. Only if you become a lawyer, you can become a judge. So better quality lawyers means better quality judges. Next one, e-courts. We need ICT in courts. Next one, medium term. What is this? I don't recall. Okay, next one, we need National Court of Appeal. What is National Court of Appeal? Presently, there is only one Supreme Court. If you have some problem, if a person in Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Andhra Pradesh, you will have to go, if he wants to go to Supreme Court, he has to travel so much. Instead, we need a National Court of Appeal with benches in all the places. One in north, one in east, one in west, one in south, so that justice dispensation is done closer to people. People don't have the burden to travel so much. These are the reforms which are needed. In fact, you can give any number. You can give maybe a few of the strongest reforms. Next one, second part is about All India JS. What is the significance? Why All India Judicial Service? Prime Minister of India is in support of it. Second one is our Supreme Court is also in favor of All India Judicial Service. What is All India Judicial Service? There are district courts, district judges. In every district, there is a district judge. There will be IAS officer, IPS officer. There will be one district judge. Their homes will be adjacent to one another in almost every district. Our district judges are appointed. They are appointed by the High Court and the State Public Service Commission together. They will conduct examination, they will conduct interview, they will recruit. They are saying that All India Judicial Service should be created, where there will be one nation, one exam for recruitment for district judges throughout the country. What will be the benefit? Similar to UPSC examination, it will attract the best of talent from the country. It will fill the vacancies. On a timely manner, vacancies will be filled. Next one, it will lead to uniformity across the country with respect to the quality of district judges. It will lead to the nation can access the best of talent, because the best of lawyers will write this. It lead to one nation, not one service, leading to integration. Presently, we have officers from south working in north, north working in south. Because of that, there is national integration. Similarly, judges from north working in south, judges from south working in north will lead to national integration. But however, there are concerns also with respect to All India Judicial Service. One thing is language issues. For justice dispensation, you need to know the local language. Otherwise, you won't know what the parties are speaking. Second one, most of the local documents will be in local languages. So one is language issues. Second one is culture issues. Person from outside the state will not understand the culture. Third one is they won't have understanding of local laws. But however, the same applies to other UPSC examination, other IAS, IPS also. Through proper training, these issues can be addressed. And also there is resistance on the part of the high courts. Presently, the Supreme Court is trying to address the concerns of the various high courts. Through that, I think all in judicial service will be the next big reform in judiciary in the very near future. You can expect it anytime. Okay, that's about AJS. Any doubts?
Nikah halala practice, good Rahul. Any doubts about this? Sir, does it affect federalism? Yes, there's federalism. They are saying that it will affect federalism because the states will make appointments of the district judges presently in association with High Court. So the states are unhappy because they think that center will get greater control. So states are unhappy. Yes.
States don't want AJS. Any other question? Okay, so Kiran does not have any question. So if Kiran does not have any question, then we can move on. Okay. Then I'll ask you one. What can I ask you? What is the technology used by Israel to prevent the incoming missiles from hitting it?
Iron Dome. Yes, Iron Dome. They are using Iron Dome. The reason, yes, Iron Dome. Then why are these people still firing Hamas missiles? Because these Hamas have 15,000-20,000 rockets. And these rockets are very cheap rockets. They are homemade rockets. For stopping every rocket, Israel is spending huge amount of money because the missiles are costly. And also Israel does not have a lot of missiles Iron Dome does not have a lot of capacity. They want either Israel to go bankrupt. They want to file so many missiles. Second thing is Iron Dome is not 100%. Yes, exactly. It's not 100%. If you fire 100, 5 or 10 will escape. So that is second one. Next one. At a time, if you fire 10, 20 at a time, then Iron Dome can take care of it. But at a time, if you fire 100, 200, then Iron Dome suddenly cannot take care of it. It's just like, even if you have the best of 100 fighters, but if you have 10,000 people from that side, even if you have the best 100 people in the world, you can't prevent those 10,000 from winning. It's like that. Fine, we'll move on. Next one, success of institutions of finance last year, discuss in the context of constitutional provisions and recent experience of the work of these institutions in India. A good question. Institutions of local self-government. This is the first part. Discuss in the context of constitutional provisions and recent experience of the work of institutions in India. Fine. First, we have to tell that the working of local self-governance depends on the state governments. Example, there was a devolution index prepared by the Ministry of Panchayat Raj, which said that few states like Karnataka, Kerala, their local bodies are performing well, but other states like UP, Rajasthan, their local bodies are not performing well. This shows that the performance of local self-governance depends on the state government. Second part is how, because see, there is State Finance, State Election Commission, State Finance Commission. State Election Commission, State Finance Commission. I think Article 243I, State Finance Commission, 240JK. Yes, State Election Commission is 243K. Their control is with the state government, state legislature. If they create strong bodies, then it will lead to strong local governance. Then 11th schedule, 12th schedule. 11th schedule has 20
9 items, 12 schedule has 18 items. How many items should be given to the local bodies will be decided by state government. If they implement 11 schedule, 12 schedule in totality, that will lead to stronger local self-governance. And there are parastatal bodies. If the state does not create parastatal bodies, what are parastatal bodies? Example, apart from BBMP, you have BDA, BWSSB, BMRDA, so many bodies like that, which will limit the power of BBMP. If the state does not create parastatal bodies, that will lead to strengthening of local self-governance. Next one, finances. If the state gives financial, if they make stronger, if the states provide finances for the local bodies, if they make them financially independent, then it lead to stronger self-governance. Next one, municipal bonds. Example, in Ahmedabad, Bangalore, it was seen that because of the states enabling the local bodies to go for municipal, to issue municipal bonds, it led to stronger self-governance. And in many states, the their local bodies are dissolved prematurely. They have a 5-year tenure. If the state government does not get majority, they will dissolve them in one or two years. This does not happen in few terms. In Tamil Nadu, I think in the last 10 years, for more than 10 years, election to the local bodies were not conducted, in spite of High Court asking the government to conduct. So if a government conducts timely elections to the local bodies, it will lead to strengthening of the local self-governance. That is the first part has been addressed. Okay. So now we're coming to the second part, discuss the recent experience of the working of these institutions. Recent experience is that Tamil Nadu example, where more than 10 years it was not conducted. We have the experience of Kerala, which has been performing very well. Then we have Haryana, Rajasthan, where sometime back they made educational qualification compulsory for contesting in the local body elections. One thing we can say is that sharing of power between center and the state in India has not been very successful, with the center trying to remain stronger, encroaching the powers of state. The same applies when it comes to sharing of power between the states and the local bodies, where the state tries, government tries to take the powers of the local bodies. Finally, what is the way forward? Way forward is we need to make changes to the constitution to make few provisions like State Finance Commission, State Election Commission, working composition, mandatory provisions, not optional provisions. We need to synchronize Union Finance Commission, State Finance Commission working. Next one, we need to create a devolution index. What is the devolution index for? What is the devolution of power from the state government to the local bodies? And we need cooperative federalism, sub-federalism. What is cooperative sub-federalism? Cooperative federalism means between center and state. Sub-federalism means between the state and the local bodies. And we also need competitive sub-federalism. That is, we need to make the local bodies to compete with each other. Next one, we need to strengthen the PESA Act, which will ensure local self-governance in the best schedule. Finally, how can we conclude? Okay, local self. It is very important for the state government to empower the local bodies. The reason is it will create a win-win situation. Win-win situation because the state government will also benefit from the services of urban local bodies. State government can ensure better services for the people, and also the burden on state government to provide services will come down. That is the conclusion. Okay. Anyone, any doubt? Sir, why no one come forward to stop the violence? Why no one come forward to stop the violence? They are coming forward. In fact, many countries have issued statements, and in UN there is discussion. They want voting against Israel. There are so many things happening. But Israel is a very powerful country. It has support of USA. So difficult to stop the violence. Okay. Praveen? Anyone, any question? No? Fine, then I will ask you something. Whom is they supporting? Are we supporting Israel or are we supporting Palestinians? Whom are we supporting? No one. Veto of USA and UNSC to block discussion. Good, Ashwini. Both no one. Morally Palestine. Yes, what Sunil told is perfect. So yes, Sunil, what Sunil told is perfect. We are actually morally supporting Palestine. We say there has to be a two-state solution. Presently, Israel is in total control. We say that there is need for two-state solution where we create one state for Palestinian people also. Let Palestinians remain happy. Let Israel remain happy. So indirectly, we are supporting both. But since Palestinians are the victims in this case, we are morally supporting Palestine. Yes, Parveen, what you are telling is correct. Balancing act. Good. Fine. Nice, guys. Explain why the doctrine of separation of power is considered as an indispensable part of our democratic setup. Discuss this doctrine in the context of India. Explain the principle of checks and balances. Okay, let us do it. Explain why the doctrine of separation of power is considered indispensable part of democratic setup. So this is the first part. Discuss this doctrine in the context of India. Okay, we will do that, and we will do the discussion. Second part, explain the principle of checks and balances. Fine. What is separation of power? He was given in France by Montesquieu, person called Montesquieu. He was a French philosopher who said that there has to be separation of power between the three organs of government: executive, legislature, judiciary. The role of executive legislature is to make law, executive should implement law, judiciary will have to adjudicate on law. If they are managed separately by these three bodies, then it will lead to good governance. If you give any two powers to one body, it will lead to tyranny. That is what Montesquieu set up. That is the doctrine of separation of power. Why is it considered an indispensable part of democratic setup? Because tyranny will be prevented. Accountability of institutions in the government will be ensured. It will protect the rights of people, because one body will not become so strong that they will encroach on the rights of people. It will prevent the concentration of power. It will maintain balance of power between the bodies, between executive, legislature, judiciary. And also, we saw the example of what happened because of concentration of power. Example, in India, during emergency, there was concentration of power in the hands of the executive, where the executive became all powerful. What happened? Democracy was threatened. People's rights were affected. That is what happened. Hence, separation of power is very important for a democratic setup. Next one, in India, do we follow clear separation of power? No, we do not. There is no watertight separation of power in India. Here, in India, there is functional overlap. And also, separation of power is followed because we have executive, legislature, judiciary. And also, Supreme Court said it is a basic structure in case one in the Bharati case. But however, in India, we said that there is functional overlap where executive performs functions of legislature and judiciary. Example is executive performing function of legislature is ordinance. Second, subordinate legislation. Executive performing function of judiciary is tribunals. Executive and judiciary. Executive, what is the executive role performed by legislature? Approval of budget. Judiciary, legislature performing impeachment process, where legislature performs role of judiciary. Next one, judiciary performs role of executive and legislature. Example is judicial activism. Finally, there is checks and balances. How there is checks and balances? Because how the legislature can keep the executive in check through confidence, no confidence motion. Legislature can keep judiciary in check through impeachment. Judiciary can be executive and legislature in check through judicial review powers. Next one, executive can keep the judiciary in check. How can the executive keep the judiciary in check? Through using the power of appointment. Okay. That is how we have checks and balances in India. Okay. Finally, we can conclude by saying that checks and balances has been relatively working well in India because in India, there is no supremacy of one institution. There is supremacy of the constitution. Anyone has any questions? Anyone? No? Okay, fine. I'll ask you something. How many vaccines have been developed against coronavirus from India?
Two.
Okay. Ashwini is the only one with the right answer, because two vaccines are manufactured in India, but there is only one vaccine developed in India. The one which Covishield, which most people are taking, that's not an Indian vaccine. It's only Indian manufactured. That Covishield is an AstraZeneca vaccine. That's, I think, a London-based body. They have manufactured the vaccine, Covishield. Covaxin is the only one developed fully in India by Bharat Biotech. So it's only one. Okay, fine. We'll move on. Compare and contrast. Next one. Compare and contrast national emergency and president's role in terms of... See, one thing is comparison. Other is contrast. Similarity, dissimilarity. Next one is between this national emergency and president's role in terms of their declaration, effect on fundamental rights, center-state relations. Very simple. So let us compare with respect to their declaration. Declaration, both declared by president. Both wrote an article on the articles of the constitution. That is one similarity. Next one, well, let us go effect on fundamental rights. There is no comparison. Next one, effect on center-state relations. In both the cases, the parliament will become all-powerful. Parliament will can make laws under state subjects, stately subjects. Central government will become powerful. They can give any order direction. Next, what is the dissimilarity? This is where, which is what is more important. With respect to declaration, national emergency is declared in all of India or any part of India. State emergency is declared only in some part of India. Okay, constitution protects for emergency to deal with extreme situations. Comparison is both president declares them. They need parliamentary approval, extended every 6 months. Center gets powers. They become unitary during emergency. But what is the contrast? Contrast is, this is announced in Article 352, this is announced in Article 356. Fundamental rights are affected in national emergency. 19 automatically suspended during war, external aggression. And 2021 can never be suspended. 32 can be suspended. Next one, fundamental rights unaffected during president's rule. Approved, which should be approved within 1 month by special majority, should be approved within 2 months by simple majority of parliament. Equation of center with all states gets changed. Equation only with the state where it is imposed gets changed between center and state. Next one, need for written recommendation of cabinet. There is need for governor's report or otherwise. There is no need for written recommendation of cabinet. Conditions are that war, external aggression, internal armed rebellion. Conditions are failure of constitutional machinery in the state. Any other difference? The other differences are that... National emergency has been imposed only once. President's rule has been imposed more than 125 times. That is one more difference. Final conclusion is that it has been seen that the emergency provisions, the misuse of national emergency came down, has been misused only once, and it has come down after the 44th Constitution Amendment. But however, state emergency still continues to be misused in spite of Bommai Committee recommendations of the Supreme Court in the Bommai judgment. So what is needed is we need to implement the Poonchi Commission recommendations, Law Commission recommendations, and recommendations of Constitutional Review Commission, so that misuse of the provisions of emergency comes down. Okay. Anyone, any doubt about this? Why only Covishield is almost everywhere? Because Covishield manufacturing capacity is more. They've invested a lot in manufacturing capacity. This Covaxin, they're manufacturing, but at a very slow pace. So that is the reason why Covishield is available more. Okay, shall I move on? Okay. Have you Sputnik? That is the Russian vaccine. What anyone has? Anyone knows about the specialty of that Sputnik vaccine? How many times will it be taken? What happens if you take one shot of two vaccines? Sorry, sir. I don't know.
maybe one shot of two vaccines, I don't think there will be a problem. It will be waste. I think it won't have much effect, because for immunity, or you just need a little bit of the vaccine, whatever is bare minimum. So in one vaccine shot, they are giving whatever is bare minimum. If you take more than that also, it won't have much effect. The body will take whatever it wants. Next one is one shot. Yes, it's only one shot. Sputnik is only one shot. And I think Sputnik, it is administered through the... There is one vaccine which is administered through the nose. I don't know which one. Just check if it's Sputnik, okay? Sputnik is the first ever vaccine. No, Sputnik is not the first ever vaccine, because Russia, remember, Russia is always behind USA. I think USA had the first of vaccines. Not Sputnik. Okay, we'll move on. Next one. We have four questions more. Indian constitution displays multiple features adopted from practice around the world. Explain. Government of India Act 1935 influenced the constitution of India. Very simple question, very static question, most static question of this paper. All of you would know what all we have copied from other countries. For example, we have copied rule of law from UK, what all we have copied: rule of law, parliamentary democracy, procedure established by bicameralism, that is the two houses, upper house, lower house, executive responsible to the lower house, FPTV, first past the post system, nominal executive, real executive. All these things we elaborately discussed in the first question, I think. Next one is with respect to USA. From USA, what have we copied? Judicial review, Supreme Court, preamble, written constitution, fundamental rights. From USSR, justice, idea of justice, fundamental duties, 42nd Amendment, 1976, idea of socialism. Next one from France, what have we copied? Liberty, equality, fraternity, freedom of speech. Next one from Ireland, we have copied DPSP. From Weimar Republic, we have copied it from different countries. First part of the question is addressed. So this much we have addressed this. Next one is, how did the Government of India Act influence the Constitution of Independent India? In fact, many parts of the Government of India Act have been taken verbatim and copied into the Constitution. What has been taken? Federalism has been taken. Three lists, Union List, State List, Concurrent List, have been taken from there, where there was Federal List, Provincial List, Concurrent List. Next one, bicameralism, Upper House, Lower House, taken from there. But lower house was indirectly elected, upper house was directly elected during that time. Next one, public service commissions at the center, state, and joint public service commission was mentioned in that act. Next one, anything else that was taken? I think there are two or three extra points which were taken. Look into that in the synopsis. Finally, conclusion is that we adopted these provisions from the Government of India Act 1935 and also from other countries. The reason was that they were best practices and we thought that they will suit our interest. And also, accepting them showed the large-heartedness of the constitution makers and the humility, because they not only borrowed them, but they also acknowledged that we have borrowed them and there is no shame in copying. In fact, there is no shame in copying the good things of others. Okay, that's it. The Public Service Commission, Federal Court. Okay, so thank you, Ashwini. It's Federal Court that is we set up. Supreme Court of India under that. Public Service Commission we discussed, Suchitra. RBI, no, RBI is through RBI Act. That's totally different. RBI Act 1939. I think that's different, Suchitra. Okay, Federal Court. Good, Ashwini. Okay, any doubts? Instrument of instructions, DPSP. Yes, there was instrument of instruction which is similar to DPSP. Good, Ashwini. Anyone wants to contribute? Anyone wants to ask any question? Anyone wants anything? Okay, when was the first time Public Service Commission was set up in India? That's the question. When was the first time a Public Service Commission was set up in India? Or UPSC? When was UPSC set up? Anyone? Quick.
1926. We know very good. We know it was 1926 because of the recommendation of Lee Commission. Good, Vinod. Next one. Focusing on technology without realizing that e-governance is basically about setting reforms in governance has meant that in the potential of e-governance has not been by discussing the statements as what we did to address the situation. Okay, a good question. There are two parts. This is one part. Then this is the second. What they're saying that just if you focus on technology, e-governance won't be a success. What is the reason? Into these things, how to scroll down. Okay. Initially, we can say, but we start by saying that we will definitely get definition of e-governance. How we define e-governance? Use of IT, ICT, information communication technology in governance for smart governance. That is simple, moral, accountable, responsive, transparent governance is called as e-governance. There are different models of e-governance, G2B, G2C, G2G, etc. G2B means government to business. G2C means government to citizens. G2G means government to government. Next, there is government to civil society. So these are the various models of e-governance. Second, RC says that there is need for need-based deployment of e-governance. There is no need for blind copying of e-governance in all the spheres. That is what second ARC says with respect to e-governance. Just if we focus on technology, it's not potential will not be realized. The reason is that digital literacy is low in India. More than 70% of population are digitally illiterate. Next one, there is a huge digital divide between men, women, urban area, rural area, between people who are between senior citizens and people in the working age population. Next, between tribals and the rest of the population, there is huge digital divide. Just if you focus on technology without focusing on other things, it will be a failure. Then there is cyber security issues. Then there is problems of digital infrastructure. What is digital infrastructure? There is no mobile phones, no computers, no internet, no electricity in many parts. Also, there can be digital exclusion. For example, present vaccination policy, it says that only if you register the vaccine, online registration, you will get vaccine. But how many people can go for online registration? What about the people in the rural areas who do not know how to use the online method? Imagine it can lead to digital exclusion. We need government process re-engineering. That is, the internal process will have to be changed. Just by making it online, government processes will not be changed. Lack of social audit is there presently. There is no intra-departmental audit. Also, focus is just on deployment of ICT, not on improvement of ICT. So these are the problems because of which potential of ICT is not realized. So what is the way forward? Way forward is address all these problems. For example, for digital literacy, focus on digital saksharata abhiyan. For reducing digital divide, focus on BharatNet. Next one, for cyber security, promote cyber swachhata kendras. Next one, digital infrastructure. Subsidize computers, smartphones. So we need government process re-engineering. We need to make social auditing mandatory for e-governance projects. So whatever problems you mentioned, just provide solutions for that, and your solutions aspects is done. Okay, finally, give a conclusion by saying that e-governance focus should not be merely on deployment of technology, but on making governance accessible at least cost for the common man. That is the intention of e-governance. That is how you conclude. Anyone, anything? You want to contribute something? No? Okay. Fine, then let me ask you something.
Have you heard about COVID test at home? Can you do your own COVID test? No? Yes? Yes, how, Kiran? How can you do your own COVID test at home? Okay. Recent via machine. Okay. They have come up with a testing kit called CoviSelf, where you can buy it, do test on your own. I think today it has been launched. That is CoviSelf using RAT. What is RAT? What is RAT, Pramod? Okay, let us continue. We are in the penultimate question, 19th one. This discussion is going to end. We discuss briefly why the definition of public authority under the RTI has been a contentious issue. Let us change the color. Okay. Discuss briefly why the definition of public authorities under the RTI Act has been a contentious issue. If you see, look into RTI Act, it talks about public authority. So the definition is contentious. That is the first part. Next one, explain the rationale behind CICs directed at national political parties should come under RTI. Okay, someone asked the question that why political parties are not coming in RTI. The answer is here. I told we'll discuss in 15 minutes. Sorry, it took me more than 1 hour to come here. Yes. What is a public authority according to RTI Act? According to RTI Act, public authority is an authority which is created in the constitution, created in the statute, which has been passed by the parliament, which has been created by any central government, state government. Next one, which is substantial funding from the government. Next one, which has been incorporated under the government as a under any act like Companies Act. So all these things are public authorities under RTI Act. Now question arises whether what is contentious, whether Supreme Court, High Court come are public authorities, whether CBI is a public authority, whether NTR or NI is a public authority, whether political parties are public authorities. So it becomes contentious because the definition of public authorities is not very clear. And also the states have taken different approaches with reference to telling whether body set up under all acts are public authorities. In the widest definition of public authority, everybody, in fact, will come under public authority. Every company will come under public authority. In the narrowest definition, all these things will not come under public authority. That is the problem. If you take it in a wide, very wide way, everything in the world, everything under the sun will come under public authority, including all these Reliance, Infosys. If you keep it narrow, then these things don't come under public authority. That is the issue. That is the challenge. Now, what are the reasons for that? The reasons is that there is no clear definition. Next one, also there is evolving of accountability culture. Earlier, people were not asking these to become under RTI, but only recently because of the accountability culture, people are asking that this should come under RTI. Next one is civil society activism because of NGOs asking, like ADR is asking for political parties to be brought under RTI because of activism by civil society. This has increased. That is the first part. Now we have addressed that there is contention. Why there is contention? We have addressed both those parts. Next one, we talk about the CIC directive. CIC directive, that is Central Information Commission. There was a question to Central Information Commission, I think in 2005, if I'm right, around that time, where someone asked, does political parties are public authorities? CIC is told all the national parties, there were six national parties during that time. Okay, 2013 it seems. Yes, I told 2005, it's not 2005, it's 2013, where they said that all those political parties are public authorities, six national parties. It's a different matter that all the national parties told that we are not public authorities, we will not reveal any information. Go to hell, to CIC. That's a different story. Even now they do not come under RTI Act.
But why CAC said that they're public authorities? They gave a number of reasons. First reason is they receive public funds from the public. They receive benefits from the government. What are the benefits from the government? They receive land at concessional rate in Delhi, in state capitals. They get accommodation in government accommodation. Their leaders get government accommodation at very affordable prices. They get income tax exemption on donations to received by the political parties. Also, people, if they donate to political parties, there is income tax exemption. They get free space on Doordarshan All India Radio, where others have to pay. So they receive a lot of benefits. Hence, they should come under RTI Act. Second thing, they have a direct effect on governance, public policy, because they contest in elections and they come to power. Even if they don't come to power, they have a direct bearing on working of the government. Because of these reasons, the CAC said that these political parties are public authorities. But however, there was unanimous rejection. The political parties might disagree on many issues, but on few issues, they are unanimous. For in this issue, they told unanimously, none of us will implement this. What are the reasons? They say that it will compromise their election strategy. RTI can be misused by other opposition parties. And also, they are not part of the government. Since they are not part of the government, they are not public authorities. This is the argument of the political parties. Finally, we can conclude by saying that political parties are one of the most important institutions in a democracy like India. Hence, if political parties voluntarily come under RTI, it will enhance the trust of the people in the political parties and in the democracy in India. And also, RTI Act provides for enough safeguards for preventing misuse of the provisions, which will compromise the political interest of the political parties. That can be the conclusion. Okay, rapid antigen test. A rapid test you cannot do at home, Pramod. You have to go to that place and you have to do there itself. You can't do at home. With this COVID self, you can do it at home. Okay? Anyone has any doubt or can we move to the last question? No? Okay, fine. Then let us move on. I'll ask you. Don't NGOs also come under public authority? Presently, the stand is that if NGOs receive government funds more than 10 lakh rupees, they come under public authority. If they receive less than that amount, they are not called public authority. That has been the present stand. Okay. Why is this thing called black fungus? Why don't we call it white fungus? Why don't we call it red fungus, green fungus? Anyone? It's black in color? No. Face infection, black in color. Yes, Kiran, very good. If you get infected by it, you will have a... It's a very dangerous because a part of your face will have to be cut. It will be very black in color. The infected region. That's why it's called black fungus. No one will... Okay, we are in the last question. Okay, in the context of recent concerns related to functioning of NGOs in India. concerned functioning of NGOs in India, discuss the need for self-regulatory guidelines, transparency mechanisms to restore the credibility of voluntary organizations. First, we have to tell about recent concerns with respect to functioning of NGOs. That is the first part. Next one is need for self-regulatory guidelines and transparency mechanisms. That is the second part. That's it. First, we can define NGOs by saying that they form a part of civil society which contribute to deepening of democracy, service delivery, proactive citizenry, etc. In the synopsis, there is World Bank definition of NGOs. That's a very good definition. You can use that. What are the recent concerns? Recent concerns are that there was an IB report, Intelligence Bureau report, which said that NGOs like Greenpeace are causing economic loss of 2 to 3% of GDP by stopping developmental projects. That is the first thing they told. That is anti-India activities are being done. Second one, CBI told Supreme Court that there are more than 30 lakh NGOs, but less than 10% of them file annual financial returns, which means 90% of them do not want to disclose about their finances to the government. That is second problem. Third one is NGOs are used for illegal activities, exploitation of women. Okay, I'm audible, right? Yes, confirm. Yes, okay, thank you. So we need to create a self-regulatory authority, for example, for regulation of media in India, news, television channels in India, there are self-regulatory authorities. Example of that is Advertising Channels Council of India. That's a self-regulatory authority. We need similar self-regulatory authorities even for NGOs. Next one, we need to lower the threshold for bringing NGOs under RTI. Presently, it's 10 lakh rupees. Maybe we can reduce it. Or we can bring all NGOs under RTI Act. That is the second thing. Next one, we need to create a social rating agencies. Presently, we have financial rating agencies, credit rating agency like Moody, Fitch, Standard & Poor. Like that, we need to create a social rating agency which will rate the NGOs based on its performance, based on its transparency. Next one, we need to make it mandatorily file income tax returns. Otherwise, cancellation of license will have to be done. Finally, conclusion is that NGOs form an important institution in the polity of a nation, because they act as a link between the people and the government. Hence, it is very important to restore their credibility through transparency mechanisms and self-regulatory guidelines. That is the answer. So we are done with all questions. I hope, why all not NGOs and RTI? Because what is the need? For example, you are running a company. If you are running a company, why should you come under RTI? Only if you are getting some government funds, you should come under RTI. Otherwise, why should someone... It's about privacy of NGOs. Why should everything be public? If you come under RTI, everything will become public. Okay, that is the reason. Makes sense. Okay, thank you Rahul, thank you. Anyone else, any questions? Shall we conclude? I hope it was useful for you. Okay, fine. When they ask critical evaluate, illustrate, examine. See, critical evaluate, critique anything. If they ask critically, then you will have to argue in favor of the statement and then argue against the statement and finally conclude. That is critical evaluate. Elucidate, examine, discuss, analyze, all these are by and large the same. Okay. There will be subtle variations. When the question comes, I will tell you. For example, if it's analyze, you have to go much deeper into the issue. If it's examine, you don't have to go very deep. If it's elucidate, you have to give examples. If it is critically evaluate, you have to speak in favor, against, and finally conclude. If it's enumerate, you have to write in point format. And if it's analyze, you don't have to write in point format. You have to write in paragraph format. So there are subtle questions like this. Sunil is asking whether to attend static or dynamic. I would say that attend whichever you are comfortable. If you are comfortable in static, attend them, finish them fast, then go to dynamic. You can do whatever you are comfortable. Okay, Sunil? If you are comfortable in static, if you are comfortable in dynamic. Fine, it was really... what can be the best sources of GS? What can be the best sources? You have standard books, you can ask. He will tell you what are the best sources. There are standard books. And he will give you the source list, what to read, what not to read. Okay. Okay, Rahul. It was really amazing talking to you guys. Thank you. Have a nice evening. Good night.